There are a million tangents that I could go off on right now. Part of not saying much of anything is to simply not go off on those tangents. Sometimes it's best just to be silent, isn't it? This world presents so many tangents to us. And, I tell you what was one of the most ruinous things that I've encountered is using caffeine, stimulants, like caffeine, because it gives you this impetuous energy to jump and make a bold start down, you know, impulsively down some tangents. And then once you start going down there, pride kicks in, you start doubling down on it and saying, I don't want to turn around, I don't want to admit that you know, I made a mistake. And before you know it, you're in so deep. And you say, uh-oh, how did I get in here? Oh my gosh, how am I going to get out of this? So many people right now are in that situation, so many. And they may even be the ones who are shouting most loudly in the world about activism, this and this and that, and how great, you know, what they're doing is. But inside, they're shaking, and they're trying to cover up their doubts by their boastful shouts. And they're to themselves, they're thinking, what have I got myself into? What have I got myself into? How can I get out of this? Because nothing worse than being on drugs of any type, alcohol, stimulants, whatever drug it is, it is a recipe for disaster for your personal life, because you become too impetuous, too impulsive, too whimsical, too silly, too childish, too willing to just jump in without looking. And then having severe regrets afterwards and saying, what in the world? How did I get into this pickle that I'm in? So, at that time, it's fabulously helpful to hear the voice of somebody that's speaking the truth and saying, this tangent is not right. You can get out of it. You've got to get out of it. Very helpful. Whereas before, these people might have been just, you know, spitting vinegar at anybody who suggests that what they're into is not right. You know, they might just be furious, off with their heads, furious, because they don't want to admit that the wheels are coming off, as if, you know, bravado of being angry at somebody who might suggest, you know, their situation is not so good. Like I say, what are you talking about? My situation is the greatest. You know, that kind of bravado lasts for a while, but eventually you say, wow, I'm in this horrible, dark place. I need to hear some voice down in the darkness saying, this place isn't right. You need to get out of there. You know, so it is super helpful to hear those kind of voices. Even though people may not admit it publicly because they're too frightened. So sometimes it's great to have someone who's feisty enough to speak the truth. I know I've always been helped by those who are courageous enough to say something what's unpopular to say. Because I say, hey, you know, maybe they're right. Maybe that's what we need to hear. Because we get into some tangents that are simply awful. So terrible. At all costs, you have to avoid that whimsical impulsiveness and the feeling of this, you know, dynamic energy that you feel, this energy can just carry me through anything. So I'll just jump in wherever. No. My case, you know, sit very quietly and no energy. And that prevents a vast array of false paths from being taken. Vast array. And don't be too quick to jump into anything. And for me, I know, like caffeine is taboo, absolutely taboo. Of course I'd like some because it would make me feel I have some energy. But from long, long, bitter experience, I know it propels me down very bad paths. Very terrible paths where they have severe regret later. And the problem is if you have friends that are also doing the same thing, you get this peer pressure not to panic and say, wait a minute, you know, where are we going? You're supposed to just keep doubling down and keep going down that path and act like this is the greatest thing in the world. We're on the side of righteousness, you know, let us keep going type of thing. But just get off those stimulants and then see how you feel. You might feel the world's passing you by, but what's happening is everybody else is jumping into these tangential paths and going on the path to ruin is what they're doing. So you're, by just sitting still and not impulsively moving, you start to become sensitized to truth. I've spoken of these times as a time when the subtle levels will begin to blend with the level that we're used to perceiving. And there's been all sorts of symbolic ways that's already been happening, but it may become more overt at this time rather than covert. We've been through a covert time the last, 40 years, 30, 40 years. Why not just say the last 50? It has been an extremely covert time. So much stuff's been happening undercover. And now it's becoming overt. I mean, the demands, the things that were maybe underground a little bit are now just boom, being brought up, becoming very overt. So we're in that time. A lot of this is negative stuff, but also there could be some very helpful stuff come from covert to overt. I've had a covert experience in that there's a lot of spiritual clarity covertly present. Tremendous. I have unbelievable dreams and awareness of spiritual truth, but it's still covert. It has not become overt. Has not really broken through. But I'm working on it. Had an unbelievable dream last night. I mean, it's just incredible. And I also saw what is keeping it covert. I've been able to, working with it today, I've been able to begin to hone in on the trick that's being used to intimidate this into remaining covert. It's really an amazing trick, very powerful trick, very intimidating. But I hope I'm getting to the point where that cannot no longer intimidate me. And if so, it's possible there could be an overt expression of bliss and grace and assurance, divine distraction, which is what we need right now. Right now we have the Olympics starting today, tonight, Friday the 27th of July 2012. That is a very overt distraction, where we just become lost in the body beautiful and the what can bodies do. I'll tell you what the best thing bodies can do is just to sit still. Let your body just be still. Keep your body in stillness. And so it's not a distraction to your spirit clarifying what is true and what is not true and seeing the difference between the real and the unreal. That's the best use for the body by far. The capacity to remain like seated and keep your mind focused like you're studying, that is the best use of the body. Body is not the superstar. The body is not the focus at all. Recovering sanity is the focus. Remembering identity is the focus. abiding in unconditional love is the focus. Like being able to accept absolutes. All attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally untrue. You know, that's an absolute. Be able to hear absolutes. Don't flee from them. Keep your body quiet. So you don't jump up and say, I gotta go get a cup of coffee. Keep the body quiet. Don't need to do anything with the body. Don't need to be a sports superstar. Because nobody of true intelligence is judging anyone else that way. The only discernment would be, you know, where's the capacity? Where's the capacity of the mind to entertain absolutes? And the capacity of the mind to sustain focus. I listened to a satsang yesterday from Panhito Masaro. It was about an hour and 47 minutes. You know, sitting there. Listened to, for the most part, my attention was there. My attention got distracted a little bit. That can happen. So the capacity to sit and consider intelligent discourse is the highest goal, the highest attribute, I think, should be held up as the purpose of existence as far as functionally is the ability to sit quietly and consider the highest type of discourse. That is the real, that's the attribute that we should all be taught, we should all strive for. And yet I have yet to come across situations that teach that or strive that. Amazing. Used to be, I know in some places in the world perhaps, that is still emphasized and given value and respect as it should be. Even that the children are taught, they see the parents are that way, the children are taught that way, to be very centered, to be very calm, to not be distracted, to keep their energy from splintering out into all sorts of tangential paths, and keep it available to focus in on highest quality discourse and differentiation, an abstract type of teaching. But my gosh, in today's world, I read something that said 93% of the world's women use up to 3 cups of caffeine a day in some form. What kind of role model is that for the children? We have a family where the parents are stimulated, caffeinated, and very, very tangential in their energy. Where do you have the parent who is very serene, very centered, very focused, and who just sits quietly for a while and says, come to the children, come here and just sit very quietly. In the stillness. Where is that? We're forced to send children to schools, by and large, except for homeschooling, where it's chaotic, absolutely chaotic. It is a severe crime against humanity to send children into these situations. You're just bombarded with all sorts of tangential energy. And what happens is you get generations completely incapable through just severe neglect to sit still and remain focused on clarification, high discourse. And when you have that, you have a world that just simply collapses. that's what we have. So we have a glorification of physical activity. Go, 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 go. I live in one of the most go, 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 go places in the world, Silicon Valley. It's like a shark tank here. I mean, everybody is got their foot on the pedal. And of course, it's the entire tech revolution was fueled by stimulants, caffeine and cocaine, as well as junk foods and pornography, fueled the whole thing. And I think a lot of us are realizing that high technology is actually bringing severe tangentialness to the world, very severe. You don't need that type of culture to sit still, to sit quietly, and to focus in on high discourse. I mean, you can put enough high discourse in a book. So really all you need is simply a book or, you know, a teacher who's professing the truth, and to sit quietly. You can either have a chair, a bench, or sit on the ground. Or throughout history, people have simply had a very simple clothes, sit quietly and study a book, which contains, you know, high truths, contains truth in it, or listen to someone give a talk and discourse and ask questions. And that is the highest type of responsibility on this planet. And those who are not doing that are derelict in their duty here. Derelict. Okay. And that's not even a strong enough word. But let's say severely negligent and derelict in duty here, if one is not doing that. That's the minimum of what one's supposed to do. So the world has become so tangential to its duty as to be entirely derelict. Entirely derelict, you could call it that way. You could call it that way. There's a few here and there, tiny enclaves, you know, of those who are using their time in the correct manner. We call the way the world is pagan world, paganism, which is some the activity of being tangential to truth. Okay. In other words, being so busy that one completely ignores one's duty. It's called the pagan world, paganism, or secular humanism, whatever word you want to give to it. Human potentialism, trying to, you know, we're frantically trying to develop the potential of the human person, whereas the true potential is to be able to discern between truth and lies. And the way to do this is you let the body simply be still, and you listen carefully, and let the inner intuition and the clarity of the mind begin to differentiate. And because we're in an upside down position, upside down, inside out, backwards, in a vicious trap. 1 minute, please. I have someone I need to talk to here. All right, right back. See, I still remain calm, sitting in the same place, not jumping up and down. Just quietly clicked onto a blank shot and then went right back to it. The tangentialness of society is what we're talking about, and how it's becoming overwhelming. A lot of people are trying to slow down. They get overweight just to slow down. You know, they don't want to be, you know, one excuse is just say, I'm so out of shape, I can't do anything except sit here. In my case, when I was young, I got sick. I was so sick, I couldn't do anything but sit. The tangentialness was just so horrible. And so some people, you know, get incredibly heavy. They get out of shape, they get sick, so I can just sit here. But when you're just sitting quietly, you're able to use your mind in a different way than if you're constantly active. This constant physical culture of athleticism is a ruinous thing. Very ruinous thing. You have what I call a juvenile world right now. Not only in demographics of half of the world being under 30 or something, or, you know, the majority of the world is under 30, I think, or 30-something, but very young. And those people tend to be very, very active and very, very tangential. And so you don't have the wisdom of those who are non-tangential, that is not being held up as a cultural ideal at all. It's being simply ignored. And so then you get a world that is guided by juvenile tangential thinking, and then the wheels come off entirely. Wheels come off. It's too late for this world. The wheels are going to come off. It has to be an institutional, culturized thing of respecting those who are fulfilling their duty here, and are able to remain centered and still and wise and clear. Only when that is given priority in the world, is the world able to stay on track. But with this incredible upsurge, demographic, population-wise around the world, the combination of that with all the gadgets and all the distractions that are present in the world, grabbing us in every direction. Click, 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 click. And a culture of emphasizing physical culture, activity in all different directions, trying to do more and more and more, trying to have it all, trying to do it all. There's nobody around in the family units. The children are just constantly bombarded at school, and then with the video games, with the television, with the smartphones, with the games, with every kind of, they're surrounded, engulfed by tangentialness, distractions. Constantly, the energy is chaotic. And when you have a whole world where all this very chaotic energy is taking place, what do you think happens to such a place? What happens is a very unfortunate situation, and that energy simply demands some sort of control of it, but it demands an extremely vigorous, active, tangential control. So a control that is like it, tangential, very active, uncentered, imbalanced, out of whack, etc. It demands that somehow it be controlled by something that's just really an iron fist, so to speak. And you have seen in history how that happens. You end up having a situation where society gets bludgeoned, culture gets bludgeoned, you know, into a pulp, because this active, this t- tangentialness cannot center in and be still and consider truth. It cannot do that. So it just ends up being reduced to a rubble. In an effort to try and back away from this tangentialness, it appeals to the wrong methodology. It appeals to the tyrant, the dictator, the fascism, the totalitarianism, the vicious bureaucracy, the mechanism by which they become reduced and reduced to rubble. They appeal to that instead of listening to those who are able to do the right thing the right way, because those have become invisible and they have no... So once you go down the wrong road, it is a disaster if you don't pull back. And time and time again on this planet, this has happened. In fact, it's like a drum beating. It's the same old drum beat over and over and over and over again. And those who are distracted by tangentialness, they don't have the time to even study this. So they're unaware of it. They don't even know about history, about what happens. It's unbelievable. And yet it's true, it happens over and over again. I mean, here we are again, worse than ever. Worse than ever. I mean, if you just look at the television shows, you literally are bombarded with tangentialness, with dereliction of responsibility. Just from just a massive onslaught. When I see something like happen to catch a glimpse of a TV show, I look at it and I just say, my gosh, this is just an all-out onslaught of tangentialness designed to distract me away from my real duty here. It's an all-out onslaught. It's designed to be that way by experts at producing this onslaught. And when your whole world is used to this onslaught of tangentialness, they end up using that on themselves to try and correct themselves. And so you end up with an all-out onslaught, the world doing it to itself, or bringing in that which can produce this onslaught. I mean, when people are viewing these TV shows, that, you know, they want this onslaught of dereliction of duty and tangentialness, they want it. Because they think that's where salvation is. The world is, unfortunately, it is backwards. People see destruction as salvation. They see death as salvation here. And so they go towards that as if it's going to save them. And so what they do is they hire these experts at producing this onslaught. Those are the producers. And the writers, the producers, the whole machinery of making television shows and movies, those are experts in producing onslaughts of tangentialness and dereliction of duty. And we, you know, people are grateful for it. They give them trophies. I mean, they give them awards. They actually have award shows where they give these people who produce this onslaught of tangentialness and destructivity and irresponsibility, they laud them and cheer, and people standing ovation and give them these statues and awards and all this stuff. And people are saying, wow, these are like the best people in the world, most creative, wonderful people in the world. Well, they're very, very capable of what they're doing. But destructivity and irresponsibility can be very capable at what they do. Doesn't make it the right thing to do at all. So when a world wants to, having pursued this extreme path, this radical, radical path of destructivity, irresponsibility, tangentialness, distraction from clarification, They may bring in experts to finish the deal, as it were, to double down on it. It can happen several ways. One way, they feel like they've gone too far, they need to pull back, and they need to be somehow disciplined to do that. And then they'll bring in someone who's very harsh, an iron rod, so to speak, who just busting heads, you know, headbusters. And they'll bring them in and be very happy, very. They'll say, "Come on in, come on in, come in." They'll give them all the power, whatever they want, the headbusters. Or they'll double down and they'll bring in a massive sacrifice of everybody. You know, to bring the belief in destructivity and sacrifice as salvation to bring that to a crescendo. Say, "Let's finish it." So they'll literally, you know, in times past and even now, it's very common for people to hire military. Mercenaries is the word. Throughout history, mercenaries have been used. Soldiers for hire. And headbusters for hire is what it really is. People hire them and do their headbusting for them. Well, the world will even hire professional headbusters to bring about this global sacrifice. And they've done that. They've done that. They've invited them in here. They've invited them into this world. This world is saturated with headbusters, and that mercenary army of headbusters has a hierarchy to it, of authority. And so the people here in the world are just like foot soldiers, the grunts. But there's many, many levels of management of this headbusting army that are in subtler levels. People give them various names, like reptilians, etc. I think it's maybe a little more complex than that. Not all reptilians are into that. They're different than humanoids, but just like there are some humans who want to be saved and clarification, there's also some reptilians who want to be saved. It's like that. It's just like a different species. Different species, but within that species there's variation, and not all of them are the stereotypical extreme authoritarian violent headbusting type of stereotype that we're aware of. But that's stereotypes are there for a purpose, because they are often true, and there are exceptions to it, of course. But basically, let's just say that within the galaxy, the cosmos, there are a lot of stratification, and there are very much mercenary groups, stratifications that headbusting is their thing. Okay, that's their thing. And headbusting on a global scale. So, you know, the world, if you're not getting back on the track and taking care of your responsibility and differentiating between truth and lies, and realizing where your salvation really is, which is remembrance of what you truly are, your true identity, you're going to be off on a tangent. And that tangent has its own momentum that builds and builds and builds. And you have a world right now that is so extremely tangential that always results in a type of headbusting taking place. There's nowhere else to go except to get back on track. And when you're so severely off the track, it simply is, it doesn't appeal to anyone to, you know, sit still and be non-tangential. It doesn't appeal at all, so it's not utilized. Theoretically, sure, everybody could do that. Practically speaking, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. Of course, we wish it would happen. That's my wish. That's my hope. But it's a vain, it's wishful thinking. It's wishful thinking. So headbusting will happen here on this planet. I know many have had dreams of this taking place in various ways. I certainly have seen on a subtle level. On the subtle level, intention can be seen, and you know what the intention is, and you know what's going to happen. But it takes a while before it actually happens here on the gross, denser level. It takes a while for intention to actually coordinate itself down at this level. But it will come. And it's just, you know, when you get off track, brutality ensues. Even when you have the greatest, best teachers here of perfect, telling you what your purpose is and showcasing it to you, even in those places where those teachers live, head busting can happen. The people can ignore it. And they get very tangential, and they go through terrible struggles. For instance, in East Bengal, it used to be Bengal, and then it was divided into East Bengal, the division between Hindus and Muslims, and then it became East Pakistan. Okay, well, and then the people in East Pakistan didn't like living under West Pakistan's authority, and they basically revolted. And you had a horrendous war in what's now called Bangladesh, was then East Pakistan. And that was the place where Ananda Maima grew up and spent a lot of time in Dhaka and that whole area. And the situation there became horrible. That's enough. It was horrible. People resorted to brutality, resorted to the worst types of brutalities, just awful. So they did not center themselves. They did not quietly. They did not spend time in clarification, in spite of what I would say is just the very finest quality, highest type of quality of example there. They still didn't do it because it didn't appeal to them. I mean, these types of things need to be built up through generations and generations. So when you lose several generations, which is what's happened in today's world, maybe two or three generations, started with not even prior to the baby boomers. I'd say the baby boomers were the second generation, but maybe it's the strongest generation. Starting with that one, from that time we have baby boomers, and then maybe we've had some baby boomers and our grandparents now, actually. So that'd be 1, 2, 3, and maybe even before the baby boomers, maybe we've had 4, but let's say 3. We've had 3 generations of getting off track severely. And that's what it takes. That's what it takes. And those who were trying to get the world off the tracks knew that. They knew that they were working to subvert several generations, 2 or 3 generations. And once you do that, it's lost. And then you have to, you know, it has to be built up generationally so that the children and the grandchildren can see the examples of the parents and the grandparents of going within in stillness and seeking truth and realizing that that is the proper usage of our time here. They can see that, and then that builds up a society, a culture that is not going to invite the headbangers in. I think there's even like some kind of gathering, headbangers ball, you know, I mean, just the music that's come in. The headbangers loves certain types of music, you know, and lifestyles and all that kind of stuff. And even they have to repent. Even they have to get back on track. You know, everybody does. So it's possible for someone who used to be a headbanger to realize, hey, you know, what did I get myself into? This is terrible. I hate it. Help get me out. And then maybe they hear a video like this and say, wow, you know, there is a whole dynamic, even though it may seem convoluted at this moment, that, you know, everything is kind of like a double bind in existence. And when we get off track, we just, it seems like we fall into an abyss and we can't seem to stop this falling, which is true. That's what happens here. So you really, you know, it's tradition is extremely important. Very important to carry that tradition through generations. Right tradition is extremely important. And of course, we want to be tangential. We say, ah, those old fogies, they don't know anything. They don't know anything. Well, what they know is they may have known their parents and their grandparents and their great-grandparents who also knew, who carried on this tradition of quietude, of stillness, of non-tangential focus and awareness. And that's been passed down, and then the values of their culture reflect this all-important non-action, as it were, or highest action. People still get it, a taste of it, by going to church, and you sit quietly in church. You're not tangential. And you're supposed to be focusing on a message, a talk about truth. That's the purpose, that's the idea behind it. But in today's society, once a week, you know, it just doesn't cut it. I mean, in the previous societies, actually, previous generations, people would pray at breakfast time. They'd get up in the morning, have a morning prayer. They would pray at lunchtime, and then dinner time, there'd be prayer and quiet reflection before dinner. And then after the dinner, there would be like discussion time about high subjects. I mean, that's how I grew up as far as dinner goes. It could have been much more, but we sat around the table and we discussed, tried to discuss spiritual teachings. Not everybody was interested in it. I certainly was. That was all important. And then the evening prayer before you go to bed, there's an evening prayer, time of reflection, evening reflection. That's a normal life. Like in our house, there's no television. I listen to a baseball game on the radio, which I shouldn't have done. But no TV. So after dinner, what would we do? Read books. Read a book. I'd read books. What would I read? I go into the library there, and there's all sorts of spiritual books, and get a spiritual book that I liked, and I'd start, you know, reading about the lives of saints, the lives of sages, and great teachers, and gurus, avatars, you name it, and aphorisms, sayings of the sages throughout history, the traditions of history, all different traditions. You know, there's been wisdom and truth has come through in all traditions. And then contemplate on that, try to do that, and try to live that kind of lifestyle. But the problem is there was too many peers who were living extremely tangential lives in their house. Their parents were, you know, drinking and committing adultery and going out to movies all the time and taking drugs and just being, you know, extremely into modern life and tangentialness, etc. And their children are just wild, totally wild. And you go to school, you get bombarded with that, and all the whole cultural revolutions came into the picture, the counter revolutions, and everybody was just getting freaky and, you know, tangential like crazy. And so when you're surrounded by that kind of thing, you know, it breaks you down, terrible. You cannot be an island in this world. It's very difficult. And unfortunately, I did not succeed. I tried, but I would not do that again, I'll tell you that. You need to be born into a culture that supports not just one family, a culture that supports your duty, irresponsibility, a responsible life. And your friends have to be that way. And your schooling, your teachers have to be that way. And the schooling you have has to be that way. And you need to have parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles and nieces and cousins and all of that. You need to be surrounded by a support system in this world. If you try to go it alone, you're going to have a hell of a time, as I did. I had to go it alone, unfortunately. Very bad. So, we're in for it. The world is really in for it. It doesn't realize that because it keeps doubling down. You see, it never looks back and see, wait a minute, you know, where did I come from? Where am I going? You know, it just keeps saying, well, I'm feeling a little bit like tired and shaky and nervous and fearful, etc. Well, let's just have another 5-hour energy, you know, and let's just charge down the road some more. Let's make another burst down the road. And just keep all these burst, doubling down, continuing a lifestyle of extreme distraction and irresponsibility. And that's where the world's going. You know, slug another energy drink. But, you know, you're having troubles, no problem. You know, get more amped up. Crank, you know, turn on the pyrotechnical music. You know, the screams, let the screams be louder. And, you know, I'm critiquing this because I've been there and done that, okay? It's not like I'm talking about something I don't know about. I know about all of this firsthand. Absolutely. I mean, I used to be able to produce that music and those screams and just put on, you know, unbelievable high energy music. That's terrible. Absolutely awful. You know, just shattering your nervous system. You know, just, you know, let's, you know, faster. You know, when you go down a tangential road, you know, you think you just got to go faster. The problem is not that it's not a tangential to what your responsibility is. You keep thinking the problem is you're not going fast enough. You're not going 24 hours a day. You think that must be the problem. I'm not committed enough to it. If it's the wrong path, committing to it doesn't change that at all. If you're going down the wrong path, speed, how it doesn't change it. You know, what the world is doing is appealing to magic. Okay, really, seriously, the world is drunk on the belief in magic. Magic is the belief that you can turn a lie into truth. If you just somehow do it the right way, figure out how to do it. You know, if you just have the commitment and the loyalty and the intensity and whatever else is needed and the energy drinks and the craziness and just go for it. Somehow you can turn a lie into truth. That's called magic. And all these accoutrements of our culture and civilization is the tools of magic. Tools of magic. When you're just sitting here quietly like this, you know, you don't need any magic. Don't need any magic. You just speak directly from clarity, which is within us, because we've not been able to separate from reality and we've not been able to change it. But we have to look at it. If we're denying it, trying to turn away from it, you're not going to see that. You can't see it. So you have to be willing to look at it. And that's all that satsang is looking at truth. Just, you know, be a little more willing, you know, overturn those rocks, look under those rocks, get throw them away so that nothing can hide, you know, no hiding place where we can hide and think that we can't see reality or truth, we don't know what truth is. And we don't have to talk a blue streak nonstop. Sometimes we can just be quiet, just be still. It's not some kind of linear process. because truth can be seen from any angle at all. You can approach it from any angle and see it. It's not some monolithic A, B, C, D, E, F, G, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. They just have to, there's nothing like that. It's your will, your intention, your willingness, your ability to sit still, to focus, to not be pedantic or intellectual about it. Again, that's a tangent. Because it's really seeing. Reason sees. It's a type of seeing. Reason is a type of seeing. It sees truth. Perception here, our sensory perception is just showing us energy, in motion and stuff. That it's got nothing to do with truth. It doesn't see truth. Can't see truth. Reason is a facility of seeing truth. Truth is not a thing. Okay. It's not, sunlight. It's not energy. It's reality. It's the laws of reality. It's the absoluteness of reality. That truth is true and lies can never be true. That's seen. But, you look at this world, you just see, the stuff that's this world. It doesn't tell you anything really about truth. In fact, it's a picture of a denial of truth is what it is. Impermanence is a denial of truth. There's no impermanence in truth. Is truth impermanent? See, this is satsang. We're doing it right now. Is truth impermanent? If it is, how could we call it truth? Truth. It would render truth meaningless, wouldn't it? It's ridiculous to say this is true. This is a truth. And to say, yeah, but, it's going to gradually degrade and disintegrate and it won't be true anymore. Well, then it was never truth in the first place. It's ridiculous to say something is life if the life is not permanent. There's meaningless statements. See, if impermanent life and impermanent truth are meaningless statements. Have no meaning to them. And I see reason can see this crystal clear. Our sensory perception of this meat suit cannot see that at all. It doesn't have any idea what's being talked about. That is why it's good to let the meat suit just sit there. Because you cannot go out and get this. You can't say, okay, I know I want to find the truth now. Where is it? Where is it? And you've been seeking through the senses for it. I need to find it somewhere. That's the activity of tangentialness, I'm going to go hike the Himalayas. I'm going to find this truth. No, just wherever you are, just sit quietly wherever you are. Not in a daydreamy way. Just sit quietly so that then the energy, the focus intensity gets into satsang, gets into absolutes, gets into reason, the seeing of reason. Reason, it refers to your ability to see truth. And it's there. I know for 100% fact it's there. And those who are off on tangents, they don't believe it's there. So for them, they say, sitting here like this is crazy because it's a waste of time. When they could be off pursuing getting it, in high speed pursuit of what they hope is their salvation, which is really their continued damnation, belief in that loss, total loss will equal total gain, that we'll gain more than reality if we lose all of reality. That's just magic formula. We've just invented it. Just made it up. There's nothing to prevent us just from making up stuff. Just saying, we want to be prime creator. We want to be greater than the prime creator. We want to be greater than reality. And we just make something up and say, if we just lose all this is just gone, then somehow we'll just automatically gain more than all of this. We've simply decreed that with zero truth behind it whatsoever. They just think, since since we're going to be prime creators, when we're prime creators, what we decree will be law. So why don't we just act as if we already are prime creator, and therefore we'll just believe that this decree is now law, is truth. That's what we're doing. As if in the future we're going to get there. So let's just say, well, let's call it good right now, that we can, you know, we can do it now too. And it's just, it's madness. It's complete madness. It's like somebody who says they're going to be a billionaire in the future. So I'm going to work hard. I'm a billionaire in the future. And they say, well, if I'm going to be a billionaire in the future, why don't I just start spending right now like I have the $1 billion? Because I'm certainly going to have it in the future. So let me just start spending it all now. Yeah. We all get pulled into those types of insanity. And we think, well, that our decrees now, whatever we want to make up is law. Because when we become prime creator, anything we say will be law. And we'll certainly, this is something we will certainly say. So why don't we just assume that it's law now? A complete assumption. That's called magic. That's magic. Just assuming that something is true now because we assume that it will be true in the future. Overlooking what is actually true right now. You see? Because we say, no, in the future we're going to change it. So since it's going to be changed in the future retroactively, it must not be true now. You see what I'm saying? See what's being said here now. I said that if something is true, you say it's temporarily true. That's not true. You know, truth cannot be impermanent, or it's not a truth. So when we say that we are going to be prime creator in the future and make our own laws different than the truth, change truth, when we become prime creator, we'll be able to decree what is true and be different than what is true now. We therefore say that whatever is true now has to be impermanent. It won't be permanent. And then we say, aha, if it's not permanent, it can't be true now, right? It can't be a truth. Therefore, we say, it's not true. It's not true. And therefore, we feel that there is no truth other than whatever we imagine it, what we want it to be. You see, it's by using a wrong premise and then using right logic based on a wrong premise to arrive at a completely insane conclusion, which is what we're doing. Let's go over this again, because it's really, when you sit still and you focus in like this on truth, you're able to see these types of dynamics which are binding us to destruction, sickness, misery, death, impermanence, and hellish suffering, just horrible. These little mistakes are binding us to it. So reason can show us this. So we'll go over it again. I said, first step, that an impermanent truth is no truth at all. It's a contradiction in terms. If something is true, how can it not be true, right? How can it be impermanent? In other words, at some point not be true. It makes a mockery of the idea, the meaning of truth. So if something is true, it's always true. It is truth. Truth is true. Now, what we say is, well, we want to be prime creator. And so we posit as a premise that we're going to succeed at that. And being prime creator means we establish what is true. Okay. And in order to be prime creator, we obviously would have to change what is true, because how could we say that we've established a truth that is already true? That's always been true. If something's true, it's always been true, right? And so we wouldn't be the ones establishing it. So we would be in a situation where we say, well, wait a minute, you know, what established truth? And be prime creator. So we literally have to change truth. So we, as prime creator establishes what is true. So we look at what is true now and we say, well, that will be changed because we are going to become prime creator. And when we do, we will change this truth into something different. We have to have our own truths. So this truth will no longer be true at that point. Okay? So far, so good. And then we say, wait a minute. Number one is that truth is always true, and impermanent truth is not true at all. And so we say, because this truth is going to be impermanent, because we're going to be prime creator and change it, that means it's not true right now. It's impermanent truth is not true, therefore it's not true now. Therefore we're not bound by it. So therefore we're not bound by the truth of the prime creator. So we're free to establish our own truths. Like it's as if we're in a domain, that is a causeless domain, only effects here, no cause anymore, no truth anymore. And we are trapped by this incredibly tricky dynamic, isn't it? But it's reason can see through it easy. Every time we look at reason just go boom, boom, boom. It's easy. And then when we get slip out of listening to reason, we go through our senses and we like say, "Huh, there's some real tricky thing going on, but I can't remember what it is." You know, say, "No, there's something wrong. Something real groovy with existence. I just don't know what it is." And then we suffer and we just tear our hair out and say, "Gosh, what is it?" Which is why it's so important to sit quietly in one spot. And don't have any feeling like you're going to be leaving the spot for the next 2 or 3 hours, okay? It's very key. And if you got all these friends that are yanking you up, say, "Hey, you know, you've been sitting there for 5 minutes. What's the matter with you? Here, throw you a controller. Let's start playing some..." You know, what kind of friends are those? Because guaranteed, you will not be able to see this dynamic that I just pointed out. This, by use of a false premise and then right logic, you arrive at a completely insane conclusion in, you know, darkness. The idea that somehow we're already free of truth. That's the inevitable conclusion. When you take the premise that we are going to become prime creator, when you take that as a true premise, you already have concluded that truth is no longer true. It's inevitable. It's absolutely inevitable. Consequence, inescapable, that you will believe that. And then there, now let's take it one more step further. Believing that truth is no longer true, we then believe that there's no absolutes that we can appeal to. So there is no truth we can appeal to, so we can't rely on anything to save us, because truth certainly saves from insanity, right? From lies. That at least we can understand simply. What saves from lies? Truth. The problem is we don't believe that there is any truth anymore. So we feel like we're not able to be saved by lies except by throwing other lies at lies. So that's when I say, when we double down, we're doubling down on tangentialism. We just keep doubling down on it. We just say, what kind of lie can I use to protect me from this other lie? And it just gets worse and worse and worse, and we bind ourselves in these extreme prisons. You have to discover the original lie. Okay, and the original lie is that we can become prime creators. Prime creator. We can become that. That is the origin of our trouble. And as long as we leave that origin undiscovered, we really are going to just flounder about horribly, because we don't believe in absolutes. We cannot. It's impossible, because again, we know that an impermanent truth is no truth at all. So how can we rely on it? You cannot. You cannot rely upon it. The only thing that we truly can rely upon is that which is permanent. Permanent truth is the only truth there is. And only that frees us from this, from impermanence, right? What can free us from impermanence other than permanence? Tell me, please. Is there some type of impermanence that can free us from impermanence? That's literally what we're believing in. There's some kind of lie that can free us from lies. There's some kind of impermanence that can free us from impermanence. That is literally the situation we are in. The horrible, horrible situation we are in is we are grasping at straws. That's the cat. He's changing his resting place, going to another place to sleep some more. We are appealing to some form of impermanence to free us from impermanence. And that is literally grasping at nothing, isn't it? What I see in the world is, when I say I see, what reason sees, the reason that is within me is within everyone. It's been placed within everyone. So when I say what I see is everyone in the world is simply grasping at straws. They're grasping at nothing, nothing at all, to save them. They're grasping at impermanence to save them from impermanence. They're grasping at death to save them from death. They're grasping at sickness to save themselves from sickness. They're grasping at insanity to save them from insanity. Grasping at lies to save them from lies. And it doesn't work. It doesn't work. Now, I'm trying to be very, very serious here. This is very serious, high discourse. It's the voice of reason speaking. I'm allowing the voice of reason to speak here because I'm simply assuming that there are those listening who are serious. They're tired of trying to use impermanence to cure the ills of impermanence. Yeah, it is tiresome, very tiresome. It's tiring. It's very tiring. It's horrible. It's hideous. Existence is hideous. And that's a very mild, statement, really. You can use every negative word in the book, and even that is very mild. It is terrible beyond anything that words can ever come up with. Anything that any concepts can ever come up with. Really, we are simply wallowing in this misery. This just total destitution. We're just wallowing in it. And we're encased, we're bound in it. We are spun around in so many different directions. We got no idea what's up and what's down, or you know, no. We just are extremely confused. So, but there's something within us that's not confused. Okay, so here's something that is so crucial. I've been through it. I've been through the confusion. Now, how have I managed to get out of it at least to this extent? Which is, you know, pretty significant extent. Not yet totally, continuously, stably, so to speak. How did I get out of it? Well, certainly not by appealing to confusion and impermanence, etc. What I found was, and certainly not by my intellect, or by my emotions, or by any sort of therapy, or medication, or anything like that. The only way I got out of it, worked my way out of it, was I discovered reason within me, the voice of reason, that could see truth. And I would get a glimpse, and I'd suddenly see, whoa, I see very clearly. And then it would go away, and I'd say, what happened to it? And I gradually began to realize and get familiar that there was this capacity that I had. I have this capacity to see truth. And I'm sure, I have been absolutely assured that everyone has the same capacity. The only difference is that I discovered it and I used it because I was in such a desperate situation that nothing else would even, you know, it's like I had to find something that would work. It's like if you're eating like a hot chili, eat a jalapeno, a habanero, let's say eat a habanero, and you're just on fire, and you're just in scorching pain. And at that point, you know, you feel like you just have to find something that works. You're not going to sit there, you know, intellectually, or you know, you just want to find what works. And so, you know, what works actually is like yogurt. Yogurt helps. Some people chug milk. It doesn't work as good as holding yogurt in your mouth and just keeping it there. You just want to find what works. So when you get into a situation where, like for me, I got pulled into tangentialness. I came into the world trying not to get pulled into it so I could be of true usefulness here. But like I said, the culture got pulled into tangentialness, and that then eventually finally pulled me into it. And then when I got pulled into tangentialness, the logic of tangentialness is faster, more intense. And so I became extremely intense and extremely fast and wound up and nervous and go, 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 nonstop, you know, that kind of thing. And I just wanted to reach the end of that path. I thought the end of the path, I would, you know, get it. And when I got at the end of that path, I got there to the end, was total chaos. I reached it. I reached the end of the path of tangentialness. And then at that point, I said, oh my gosh, this is the end of the path. There's nowhere else to go. And at that point, I was suffering so bad that I said, hey, I ate 10 habaneros or 10, you know, Maruga scorpions. And I was just like completely devastated. And I needed something to cool it down. And then, so I asked, you know, if there's anything that can help, I'm willing to accept it. And right then and there, I suddenly saw truth for a moment. And I said, holy cow. And I said, oh my gosh, we are really trapped in this horrible, horrible dualistic insanity. This insanity, we're enmeshed in this insanity. I saw it. And then I said, my gosh, I'm capable of seeing that. And then I said, I want to see it again. And then I began to get glimpses of reason, of little seeings, noticing this, that. And gradually over the years, I saw more and more and more clearly and became more and more familiar with reason. Then eventually I came across a curriculum that was grounded in right premise, which is A Course in Miracles, is grounded in truth, true premise, and has tremendous amount of reason there. And so I was able to practice using reason, seeing for myself. You know, it's not just the words, it's the ability to actually see it for yourself. And then I gradually pulled out of this incredible, terrible path of tangentialness. Because the reason why I went down it so bad was because I wanted so badly to be of help in this world. And when you get off on a tangent, you have this desire to be helpful, then you think that you have to go all the way on this tangential path to its very end. So I did it. I went all the way to the very end. Whereas most people, they just kind of, you know, wander around a little bit. And I was extremely focused on getting to the end of this path, which was going to be total chaos, which is actually symbolized. Just all this chaotic energy, just completely chaotic with no point of reference whatsoever, no truth whatsoever to pull you out of that chaos. That was the experience I had. I told you that when you believe that truth is impermanent, then you think there is no truth here. We have no truth at all. There's no reference. There's nothing to get you out of that condition. If you want to get out of impermanence and everything's impermanent, there's no way to get out of it. So what I discovered at the end of this path was just complete, total chaos with nothing to pull me out of it. Nothing. Nothing. I saw it. There's nothing to get me out of this. And at that point, I literally screamed. I said, if there's anything that could get me out of this, I'm in with that. And that is when reason introduced itself to me. I said, look at this. I said, wow, there is a way to get out of it. There is truth. There is a truth. So there is like an anchor, you know. I'm sorry, there is like a lifeline, a life preserver. Someone can toss you a lifeline, life preserver. You can put it on. It's like you're in this ocean of choppy chaos, and someone throws you a lifeline, and you put on a life preserver, and now you're not sinking. You know, still you're getting battered by the chop and the waves, and you go under many times, but you always pop to the surface. You're like a cork at that time, and then gradually you get reeled into this ship, and then you get on the ship, and then the waves don't bother you at all. The chop and the waves are like nothing. But as long as you're down in the ocean of relativity, of duality, of believing this false premise and the logic of it keeps, you know, seeming to be inescapable, then you keep getting hit by this chop and waves, and you're sputtering and, you know, I don't know if you've ever swam in the ocean. I used to spend a tremendous amount of time in the ocean, even in, during the most severe kind of storms as a surfer. And I just got hammered, absolutely hammered, believe me. Almost died a number of times, choking, just couldn't breathe, just, you know, it was horrible, horrible. I'd go out in the biggest storms, and just crazy stuff. And just, the ocean just hammered me bad. One time I hit the bottom so bad, my entire face layer just simply peeled. The whole face peeled because the impact just blasted my face so bad that it killed all the skin. It was unbelievable. Unbelievable. And the pounding sometimes, I would sometimes, I'd spend like hours trying to get out through the shore break. In a big storm, you just like, you'd have like 6 to 8 foot waves just absolutely crushing you nonstop. I could never even get out. And I would literally get smashed by these very powerful waves, you know, for hours until I would come in and I would just collapse on the beach. I couldn't even walk. I was so tired, you know, just destroyed. It's like that kind of intensity. You know, I feel like I have got to learn how to surf the biggest waves, most powerful waves. But I didn't have it in me, you know, I didn't have the strength to do it. Maybe the biggest wave I ever surfed maybe would be like a 12-foot wave or something like that. Which was incredibly scary. The guys that surf the big ones, oh, no. That's insane. That is really insane. They're very athletic and like a gymnast, you know. I mean, they're really, you really have to have your balance and your eyesight and your coordination and your awareness of the total picture. Okay, you cannot get obsessed with anything. You gotta have like kind of a this panoramic awareness that doesn't get lost in the moment. You know, in the moment, but not lost in the moment. Because you realize you still have to make this wave. And then when you make it, you've got to be aware of the sets that are coming in. Because if there's a big set coming in, you're going to get crunched, get caught inside, and just get pounded. Just get pounded. So I know what it's like to be hit with this chop, not only the ocean, but in life. It becomes completely choppy, and waves just smashing you. Because have got into this tangential path that is based on a false premise, and then really you're simply clutching at straws, because everything is just relative. There's no absolute truth. There's no permanence. There's no true love. There's no true life. There's no truth. There's no permanence. There's no reality. Everything becomes relative, and then you just get smashed by existence, you know, by more someone who's more powerful, you know, in their waveness, you know. There's all sorts of in existence, there's all sorts of those who have assumed that they're going to reach certain states, because existence is really just an assumption. So there's all sorts of assumptions within existence, like I said, that we assume we're going to be prime creator. So we assume then that retroactively we're going to get these powers bestowed upon us. So we just assume, well, you know, forget about cause and effect. Let's just have them now. So there's all these assumptions of power in existence. And those assumptions are just, you know, like waves in an ocean just smashing into each other all over the place. And if for my case, I said, no, I'm not going to assume anything until I reach the end of the path. So I didn't feel any power at all. I was powerless. Because I said, once I reach the end of the path, then we'll see. But what I found out was total chaos, which then left me just complete state of hopelessness, virtually except for that glimpse of, you know, reason that reason gave me. So I was just getting smashed in every direction by existence. Any little... I was literally like the weakest, most disenfranchised person on the planet, and any little thing would devastate me. It's like a little baby in this massive storming ocean who has no power to swim or even move, just getting hammered by everything. Because I had gotten seen this total chaos, of relativity and no anchor point anywhere, no absolute anywhere, except that I had this glimpse, which then, you know, gave me then a starting point to try and pull back from getting battered so badly. And nowadays I don't get battered so badly like I used to. It used to be the tiniest thing would completely devastate me, completely just devastate me, like I was drowning. Any little thing, you know, just kind of a look, you know, just kind of a look. So I know where people are at in the world, because I've gone the whole spectrum. And you know, you have people who are going down tangential paths. What happens is they become very sensitive, muy sensitivo, muy delicado, you know, very delicate. Because looks just kill them, you know. It's like, you know, that person, you know, looked at me. I didn't like the way they looked at me. That made me feel very uncomfortable and ruined my day. And I'm feeling very uncentered. And you need to fire that person. I can't function like that. When you have whole groups going down tangential paths, you get this group sensitivity, it's called. And nobody calls them on it because everybody's the same. And they think that hey, we're helping save the world by going down this tangential path. And they develop extreme sensitivities. And again, there's no culture of anyone calling them on that. And then they feel that anyone who bothers their sensitivities is wicked, as evil, and then they use their might to crush them. That is what you have in this world. When you have so much tangential paths, so many groups, all these groups in the world are on a tangential path, and inherently you develop a feeling of weakness and batteredness, and you end up being extremely sensitive to minor, tiny things. Like now, I just brush everything off, like water off a duck's back. You know, very little bothers me. There's a few things still that scare me, because I see the tangentialness of the world, these groups, group consciousness, mindset, going on a tangential path, become unbelievable tyrants. Tyranny. It establishes tyranny. Because then the slightest little thing can devastate them and feel like their whole dynamic is just being destroyed. And they think, oh my gosh, I'm never going to be saved because I'm just falling apart. And, you know, that they become insultable by anything. I remember I used to be basically insulted by everything. No matter what, no win situation, whatever you'd say, I'd find it insulting. And that's where we're at. The world is rapidly going in that direction. And when you get this institutionalized, then you have tyranny and you have genocide, you have self-destructiveness, you have the headbangers come in, head knockers come in, big time. It's inescapable. Unless one turns to the voice of reason and says, wait a minute, is there anything that I can grab a hold of that is stable and is not so easily disturbed? And then the voice of reason shows up and you say, wow, voice of reason is not upset by anything. I came across some teachers that were not upset by anything. Ananda Mai Ma was never bothered by anything in this world. That was her declaration. That was the testimony of everyone around her. She said she never experienced a moment of anger in her entire life, not even the tiniest moment, not even the fractional moment, and not even a tiny fractional bit of anger. Never experienced it at all. She said that was her testimony, and those who around her knew that this was true. So I came across the voice of reason, said, look at this one, you know, see what's possible. And I saw that and I said, wow, which was a revelation to me, because everything bothered me, everything. And it said, how in the world is that possible? That's the first time I saw her in a video. I said, you know what, this person doesn't seem like anything's bothering her at all. And I was struck with that, and I said, my gosh, how is that? I'm seeing it, I know it's true, but how is it possible? I've got to find out, how is that possible? Because I was tired of being bothered by stuff. And you know, like, you know, drivers get road rage, people get upset. Like now, I'm not upset by anything driving. I drive all the time for a living, and people act in crazy ways all the time. I was in a double left-hand turn lane at a light in, you know, two lanes going left, turning left, and I was in the outside lane, as it were, and someone else was the inside turn lane, and we turned, and the other car just completely drifted over into my lane and just absolutely cut me off. If I hadn't have been anticipating it and saying, I gotta check that car, see if it's drifting, boom, we would have had an accident for sure. I would have smashed right into it. I hit the brakes, I went over to the curb, you know, and just stopped and to avoid an accident. And I just say, like I said, come on, you know, come on. But drive down the road, nothing, you know. Just, I drove right, the person's right in front of me. I didn't, you know, scream, honk the horn, you know, or get all upset, nothing. And then they went on, and I stopped at the stoplight, and I didn't feel any, you know, upset. Of course you feel, you know, like, wow. You know, like, wow, you know, why'd you do that? You know, come on. I said, come on, lady, wake up. You know, come on, wake up. Don't drive that way. That's fine. But I didn't feel any anger. I didn't feel any anger at it. And I get instant troubles on the road of people who are distracted, and you know, just stay very calm, undisturbed by any of it. Doesn't disturb me at all. Whereas in the past, you know, wow, it's like, you know, making every traffic light was like extremely important. You know, it's like, I got stuff that I gotta do. I can't be stopping at a traffic light, you know? I have a friend who down in Mexico right now, and he tells me the people down there are just insane on the roads. That they literally just go right through traffic lights. I mean, they are so tangential, on the tangential path, which again is one of speed and getting fat, going faster and faster, not let anything stop you. That's the feeling. You've got to be more and more active, do more and more, take more and more drugs, stimulation, go, 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 go. The whole country where he's at is like that. Everybody is driving like crazy, cutting everybody else off and screaming at each other and just, constant road rage. And I've talked to a lot of people from Mexico who say, you know, it is horrible down there. They'll pull a gun on you if you get in their way and slow them down. Just is an example of what happens with tangentialness when you get off on a tangent and you start adding drugs to it, and you all of that, you the culture disintegrates because people go into road rage. And we used to have some road rage in here in the Silicon Valley. It's calmed down. It's actually calmed down a little bit. The recession calmed it down. Yeah. People were so shocked, you know, and so many jobs were lost, and everything was so slow. People were just kind of in a stupor, you know, and everyone became kind of civil again. But it used to be pretty bad, pretty bad. All the time, people would pass me on the right. I'd be like in the slow lane, and they'd go right on the shoulder and pass me. Or if you're going slow, they just go right along the right. And numerous times, I was like making a right-hand turn. And I would check to see, I say, I wonder if someone's trying to, crazy persons, and there's somebody passing me on the right, I would have just smashed right into them. The people just, they don't stop. A lot of drivers here, they refuse to stop. They don't stop at the on-ramp lights. There was a time, and it's still pretty bad, where I'd say half the people in the carpool lane were single drivers. Blatantly disregarding that you have to have at least two riders, just completely disregarding it. They didn't care. And there's not enough money for police, so there's hardly any police. There's nobody going to stop them. They just go right into that lane and poof, gone. They don't stop at the metering light. They go around, ground you. You know, it's that type of thing. Whereas in the past, you never saw that. Never. As a lifelong driver on the road a lot, I can very well judge how society is by how people drive. And oh my gosh, it has changed so radically from how it used to be. My gosh, there's still a lot of good people, okay? In the USA, there's still a lot of good people. And I'm very courteous to people, You want to go in, go in. If you spread good karma that way, if you want to spread good karma, be very courteous in your driving and let someone merge, you know, let them do it. And there's still a lot of good karma, still a lot of good people here. Unfortunately, the way things work in this world is those people who go very far in a group think on a tangential path and become very sensitive and easily bothered, they grab a hold of the reins of power. They make that their objective. Once they gain hold on the reins of power, then they look out in the world and everybody's bothering them. You know, they're like a hammer and everything they see is a nail. And so they then use the apparatus of power, institutional power, to hammer down everybody else. So it's not like people in the world have gone bad entirely. No, it's not that way at all. There's still just a tremendous number of very good people here that comes from their great-grandparents and their grandparents and their parents and their relatives, and they still have some decency. They still have a feeling of still some quietness, be able to be still and calm, etc. They still have some of that. Okay, but it's slipping away fast. But the problem is the radical seize power. Those who have gone down radically fast on a tangential path in a group way, a single person is not going to do anything in that direction. For me, I had zero bar, you know, because I did it myself. I didn't belong to any group at all. I said, let me find out the truth, and then, you know, I'll report back on it. And I found out. The end of a tangential path is total chaos. All tangential paths end up in total chaos. It's the one destination for them all. And then you end up feeling, even before you get there, and then on the path of recovery too, very, very easily bothered in a severe way. And like, it's scary. It's very scary. Very scary. Having been there, I know how severely bothered you can become about any little thing. You notice everything and you feel like, you know, there's a nail, I want to hammer it down. There's another nail, I want to hammer that. You look out and you see, my gosh, there's nothing but nails. I need a bigger hammer. Okay, so these groups who have gone down tangential paths, and there are many of them in the world right now, they're looking for a bigger hammer. That's all they're looking for, is a bigger hammer, because they see, my gosh, there's billions and billions of nails, and how can we hammer them down with a small hammer? We need a huge hammer. So they aim for the reins of power, and then they get a huge, huge hammer, and then kaboom, they hammer all those nails down that are bothering them. And stillness bothers them. Calm bothers them. Just ordinary stuff bothers severely. And if you're not agreeing with them exactly, you bother them extremely. Extremely. To the point is, if they have the means, they will hammer you down for sure. And history testifies to the truth of what I'm saying. There is, all of this is completely foreseeable, inescapable. Okay? Tangential paths, where they lead to and what they result in is this extreme sensitivity and upset, because you feel so helpless and weak, because you think there's nothing permanent at all. But once you get a glimpse of the voice of reason, then you are not subject, you will not get pulled down into that great wickedness of hammering other people down. I did not go that direction. You know, the temptation is there. And, you know, sometimes I try not to ever hammer anybody down. And if I do, it's a mistake. And kind of correct that mistake. I try to speak in language of truth, voice of reason, broad panoramic pictures. But it is important to realize that when large groups of people go down that tangential road together, it develops this groupthink, okay, where sensitivity is not realized. It develops this righteousness, thinking that it's everybody else is the problem, that our sensitivity is righteous. And if someone's bothering us, it's because they're doing something wicked, doing something bad, doing something really bad. And then they feel completely justified in hammering, wielding the big hammer, being, you know, banging heads, trying to get rid of what bothers them. And as I said, when you go down that path, everything bothers you. Everything bothers you. Nothing that doesn't bother you, because you feel unstable. Wow, this is making me feel, have a feeling of instability, because somebody didn't do what I told them to do, or they didn't do it fast enough, or I didn't like the attitude they did it with, or I just feeling kind of irritated today. You know, you let significant groups gain institutional power, the reins of power, the big hammer. That's bad news. They're going to use it. History, again, is testifying this fact. And, like I said, there are a ton of good people in this world who are not so easily bothered, because they still have this intuitive feel that they need to not stray so badly. They haven't strayed so badly, but the more you pump caffeine and drugs into the world, the worse people stray. Which is why it's supremely important to keep drugs out of the world. Supremely important. I know there's a big push now to legalize drugs, which is absolutely disastrous. Because I've been through that whole thing. I know exactly what it's about. It's disastrous. It will result in absolute disaster. Because what those drugs do is they blind you to the fact you're going down a tangential path, and they actually propel you down it faster, and you become more and more irritated and more easily bothered. Okay, the drugs are very tricky, because they make you feel more mellow, so to speak, but what it really does is just dulls you to this inner voice that's telling you, hey, you're going down the wrong path, you got to turn things around. Now you take the drugs and say, no, everything's cool, everything's really cool, you know, and I think I see truth out there. I see everything's more bright and everything's, you know, more distinct, and we think that that's clarity. It's not clarity. Clarity is the voice of reason. When we talk about clarity, we're not talking about an aesthetic experience that the world seems brighter to us, that colors are brighter. I mean, anybody can take a drug and the world seems more interesting, you know. They say that people don't drink to make themselves more interesting. They drink to make other people seem more interesting to them, because everything seems dull and blah, you know, which it is. And so people take drugs to make the world look more interesting and make them think they're on the right path. And there's all sorts of mental tricks you can also use to try and make the world seem more interesting. But that's tangential path. What you need to see is a voice of reason. You need to connect with that, and that'll show you what truth really is. Okay, and that's, I mean, it is so far beyond any aesthetic experience of this world that it's you know, ridiculous. You can't even compare the two. The notion that somehow that we can somehow make this world seem more appealing to us, seem brighter. Colors are brighter, more saturated, more intense. Everything seems to be a dance of energy and all this kind of stuff. That is just fool's gold. That is fool's gold. Absolute fool's gold. And that, you know, is the religion of those on tangential paths. They love it. They think, yeah, you know, this path's going to work for me. But again, if you pursue it to the end, you find total chaos there. And you will, the more you pursue it, the more easily you get irritated. When you're among your friends who are all on the same, you know, lockstep with you, you think, oh no, I'm not easily irritated. I'm just irritated by those people over there. I'm not, my friends like me. I like my friends, so everything's fine with me. But it's those people over there that are like, really hate them, you know. God, I just wish they would just die. You know, they're so terrible. We got to find out a way to get rid of them, because they're just, you know, really terrible. But me, no, I'm not irritated by anything. My friends, everything's fine. No, that is the delusion, total delusion that happens. But going on this path myself, just me, I didn't have that. I said, wow. Everyone's bothering me, but, you know, they're not bothering anybody else, so it's definitely me. You know, the botheration is here. You know, it's I'm unstable. You know, I feel this instability because of lack of permanence. You know, the belief in that truth is true has been suddenly disappeared. I can't find it. The belief system doesn't have it there for me. So I have to recover that. But when you do it as a group, you don't have that honesty there, because you can always, you know, you go corporate on the spiritual, on the tangential path. Tangential paths, they're infinite tangential paths. You go corporate there, you don't have that reference, you know. You just, everybody seems to be the same as you, you know, and you don't realize where you're going. And you don't realize it is you, because you've gone down a wrong path. You think it's someone over there that's you know, bothering you. And so we're in a world now where everybody's being bothered by some other group. You know, the hate is growing. And when you're grounded in the voice of reason, forgiveness is there. You just see it. You see it. You say, nobody's ever done anything to harm reality. What's the basis of upset? I know truth is true. It's permanent. And it's never been harmed. It'll always be permanent. I'm already, you know, pre-qualified for that. That is what I'm entitled to. That's my inheritance. I'm going to get there. So where's the harm? Who's harming me, really? Who's harming reality, my reality? Nobody. Nobody's harming it in any way. So what reason do I have to hate anyone or hammer anybody down? No reason. They're just, you know, they're just not causing any problem to my home at all. My home's not being wrecked. My apartment here in this world might be wrecked, which is not good, but my home isn't being wrecked at all. That's why it's important to get a glimpse of home. Brings forgiveness, brings calm, and brings an attitude that you're not going to try to hammer anyone down. Does that mean that you're not concerned about what's taking place? At some level, you can reach that point where you're not even concerned at all. Ananda Mayama had zero concern about the world. None. All these wars are spinning around her. World War I, World War II, Korean, Vietnamese, you know, the partition of India, and then the battle between East and West Pakistan, and all the wars all over the world, droughts, famines. I mean, Bangladesh had a horrible famine in the 70s, you know, because of the cyclone that came up the Bay of Bengal and just wiped out flooded the country. It's horrible. She never expressed any concern about it whatsoever. She was unconcerned about this world, knowing that our true home is not being flooded. Our true identity is not being starved. Our true identity is not dying. All this is just dreams. It's just fantasy. It's just assumptions. So she literally expressed no concern. And a lot of people asked her about that, saying, you know, that's what's going on. We have this, well, in World War II, 6 million, you know, well, 2 to 6 million, depending, you know, who knows, Bengalis, their own, you know, homeland, starved to death, because of the Japanese invasion from the east, from Burma into eastern India. The Allies basically did a scorched earth policy in case the Japanese were able to establish bases there. They destroyed all the food crops, so they wouldn't be able to get any supplies, and then they tried to cut their supply lines off, so, you know, they'd have to live off the land, and then they destroyed all the crops, so there's no more food for anybody. And they also requisitioned all the ships, all the means of distribution, so whatever food the Japanese could get, they couldn't distribute it. Okay, so all the trains, all the boats, everything they requisitioned, and so there was no food and there was no means. Whatever stockpiles they had, they couldn't move them anywhere. And in 6 million, 2 to 6 million Bengalis starved to death. That was in, like, what, 1944 or something, 44, 45, 43, 44, 45, whatever. Somewhere there during World War II. And you have pictures of it. I mean, it's just horrifying. Just horrifying. What happened? I mean, the poor could maybe plant crops. Maybe they had managed to hide some. They could scavenge. They had some land they could scavenge on, and they may have survived. The rich could buy on the black market something to at least survive. The middle class starved to death because they had no land, and they couldn't get any. The rich were spending all their money on trying to buy on the black market some food, so the middle class had no money and no food. Starved to death. And of course, Anandamayi was in India subcontinent this whole time, of course, and she never expressed any concern about it. Pretty amazing. And so devotees would ask her about that. Like, what's going on? How come you not do anything? She says, well, you know, if you want to do something to help, then I will, you know, grace will provide. But she says, as for me, you know, I see life and death as exactly the same. I don't see any difference here. Meaning, you know, physical existence and then the afterlife existence. No difference. No difference. And the suffering that they're going through is what people would say is karma, which is a difficult thing to grasp. But it's basically, when we're trying to become prime creator, we have to suffer this loss-based scenario as a way to forget what we are and as a way to believe we can destroy truth and make it impermanent and then therefore become prime creator. And so we draw to us, we imagine loss and death and sickness and destruction, etc. Purpose of this whole dream is destruction and loss and suffering, misery. It's horrible. That's the purpose of it. So of course people draw destruction to them. And so these people there, they experience this horrible, you know, starving to death. And most of them took it. You never hear about it. You never hear about it. Because they took it like good soldiers, you know. They didn't complain. They didn't complain about it. They just said, this is fate. This is what it is. And here we go. But on another level, of course, by going through this, they believe they're empowering themselves to become prime creator. That they're proving that life is impermanent. That proving that scarcity is true. Supposedly, you know, this is the logic of existence. Logic of existence is insane. It's upside down. And where Anandamayi Ma saw the logic of truth, and saw truth perfectly clearly, and said, hey, your real home is unaffected. Your true identity is unaffected. Your true life is unaffected. There's no scarcity of your life. There's no starvation. There's no scarcity. There's no death. There's no suffering. There's none of that. And so all she did was she reminded everyone of that fact. So you didn't see her agreeing with the dream and saying, yeah, you're really all suffering and dying. She said, no, in reality, you're not experiencing any of that. And so she reassured everyone of truth. And that is what a great teacher does. A great teacher literally is unaffected by any suffering in this world because they know it's all a scam. Suffering is something we've made up in an attempt to change what we are and become prime creator. And it's our arrogance that attracts it to us. We're trying to accomplish the impossible through destructivity and loss and all of that that it brings. And so it's our own arrogance that we can destroy reality that is bringing this upon us. So what she does, and any great teacher does, is they simply shine into the world the fact that reality is not being destroyed. She was here during all these problems of the 20th century, and they were massive. Again, the horrible devastation of Bangladesh in 1970, was it 74 or something, the great flood. And she, again, here that the whole time, people starving like crazy, sick, cholera, dysentery, horrible. Reassured everybody. Your home is not suffering any of this. Your life is not suffering any of this. Your truth is not suffering any of this. Everything is perfect. Everything is perfect. In reality, this dream, it has to be this way, she says. It's the dream of suffering and destruction. So it will always be that way. So it's useless to keep knee-jerk responding to the suffering of the world. What we have to do is reassure ourselves that this is just a dream that has no consequence whatsoever, and reality is perfectly untouched by this dream, and there is a way to remember this fact. You can do it, because she would say to everyone, you can do it. You can remember that this is true. If you just sit still and you let the voice of truth listen to it. Just listen to it. And just see what it's showing to you. It just says, look here, and you can see it. That's how we're truly helped in this world. That's how we're truly helped. The great teachers truly help us. There's some teachers here now. They're not great teachers yet, but they're trying to help us. Bentino Massaro. I don't know how he's going to turn out, but he certainly is trying at this time. And that satsang that I watched, he was hit with some very severe questions. And the way he answered them was extremely good, extremely well answered. You know, very courageous, the way he answered those questions. Now, he's a little nervous. I don't know where that's coming from. Maybe just he's under a lot of pressure, because they're hitting him with some tough questions. Like someone said, hey, what about all these people starving to death? Doesn't that bother you, you know? And what about the Nazis? And what about this? And what about rape? Because all these things come up. Don't you feel compassion and sympathy and concern? He says, no, that's just someone reflecting. In other words, he didn't side with the victim. He pointed out truth of the situation. We are bringing that upon ourselves. It's not so much that we are bringing it upon ourselves. It's that the dynamic of the idea of trying to be prime creator brings it upon us. See, that's a clarification that is not being made. I'm making it right now. We're not bringing anything upon ourselves so much. Okay, we are collectively, any aspect of spirit that chooses to want to be prime creator, they go into a scenario where they're simply being hit from all sides, and it's chaotic. It's chaotic. So you don't escape from it bit by bit. As far, you have to escape from it all at once as a package thing. Yeah, so this is truth. And so Bentino answered the questions in a way that I haven't seen answered here in a long time, in a tremendously courageous and accurate way. He speaks from a traditional non-dual standpoint. I don't teach traditional non-dual teaching. I go at it more from A Course in Miracles, the way that Jesus teaches, which I find to be more profound, more panoramic, and greater context, really. I really do. I mean, for my money, A Course in Miracles gives the highest type of teaching. But non-dual teaching is also very, very good. Very good. And he did a very good job of it. Very, very good job of it. And some of the answers, I was shocked. I said, my gosh, this guy is really holding fast to truth here, and is, giving very unpopular answers. Whew, man, and I think people respected him for it. He didn't back down. He didn't say, well, in the case of rape, yeah, that's just awful. And he said, no, the same thing applies. It's no different. It's all the same. It's all the same. It doesn't matter what you may think, and that's not a way to endear yourself to these groups who are on tangential groups, who are very sensitive about everything, who are capable of giving rise to utmost indignity, utmost outrage, hysterical outrage, about any little thing. If someone doesn't agree with them, what they want you to say, they just are able to summon this, howls of ferocious outrage. Whereas in that satsang, Bentino answered these questions very well, very accurately, and the people must have been shocked. But they weren't, screaming bloody murder for his head. They just say, thank you for your response. Now, I don't know how they're going to relate to it later on, but that shows you the power of satsang. Power of satsang is very important. Whereas, a group of people who want to get the truth, you cannot indulge in feeling insulted. You cannot indulge in being bothered, like, oh, that really bothered me. That answer really bothered me. I'm outraged. I'm going to act up now. I'm going to act up right now because you didn't say what I wanted you to say. Now, that's the voice of reason says, no. Listen to what's being said and see if you can see the root of it, the root of it. He's not trying to insult anybody there. Like I said, I'm not endorsing this particular satsang because I don't know, you know, hindsight, how it's going to turn out. I don't know where the nervousness is coming from. Not sure. It may be, like I said, that he's feeling the pressure, you know, by these questions are hit, you know, these people are really hitting him with these questions saying, where do you stand? And he's what he's saying is supremely unpopular in the world. Supremely unpopular. That, you know, there is no victimization, which is ultimately true. Ultimately true. Relatively, there is victimization, but ultimate truth, there is none. That we, by choosing to want to be prime creator, we must then partake in a dance of victimization. That we must feel that we're being victimized. We have to feel that. We have to feel loss. We have to feel impermanence, which is a feeling of victimization. So we can't escape it. It's not possible to escape it. So what we do is we make it feel like somebody specifically is victimizing us instead of realizing this idea is victimizing us. So it's not, you know, it's not quite like people aren't victimizing us. I mean, there is that play, but it's not their fault, so to speak. It's the fault of the idea of wanting to be prime creator that we are trying to embrace. That's the fault. So you have to forgive people. So, you know, there's A Course in Miracles gives a slightly different context. But he was pointing out the absolute truth of the situation. But the context is not being so clearly, not entirely being pointed out. In a non-dual way it is. But it's a little, for me, non-dual is a little weak. It's a little weak. And it leaves a lot of wiggle room. It could be better. But it's still good. It's still very good. And he did a fantastic job. At the same time, with body language that was a little not quite in sync with what he was saying. So that's coming from somewhere. Could be that the severe pressure on anybody who's trying to wade into the world at this time and teach absolute truth is taking on an unbelievable task. Unbelievable. So I don't know if he can do it or not. He's trying. But whew, for someone of his age group to do that is just supremely difficult, because he's going to be hit with demands to not irritate certain groups. And if he sticks to the truth and says, hey, you know, no, I'm sticking with this, you know, those groups are not going to like that, because you can't be all things to everybody here in terms in that way. Like Anandamaya Ma, she upset a lot of people, really did. And she wasn't bothered by that at all. She said, those are my ornaments. I love it. Didn't bother in the slightest bit. But yeah, a lot of people wished a tremendous ill upon her. They said it was outrageous what she was doing. And, because she, you know, would not, you know, say what people wanted her to say. And so there's all these groups now who are gaining tremendous power in this world, and have already gained it, actually. And now they're starting to turn the screws, and you know, you start talking about there's no such thing as victimization. You know, that's heavy stuff. I've said that in other videos, but he's in front of a group saying that. That's a different thing. I've just made it, you know, made videos, you know, talking the same type of talk and explaining it. But when you go on the public and you're speaking to groups and putting yourself out there as going to groups, be organized by people, etc., etc., than all sorts of special interest groups who are on tangential paths, who are wanting to get rid of this feeling of irritation they have with other people. They come to you and says, hey, look, you know, these other people are really bothering me. How can you help me change them? How can you change them? Can you change them for me? That's what they're really asking you. They're not interested in truth. They're interested in getting the spiritual teacher to put the hammer down for them. They just assume the spiritual teacher must have a big hammer, you know. So they, why don't you hammer this group down? Now, if you stick to truth and say, no, that's totally bogus, you know, as Bentino did in the satsang, that's going to put yourself on a lot of pressure. And so maybe he's feeling this pressure and is feeling kind of a little nervous, like, wow, you know, I hope this works. I hope I can do this. This is kind of where he's coming from, because he's sort of working into it. You know, he's not a satguru at this point. None of my mom was born this way, and even from before birth and always, she was always 100% abiding in truth. Never had been on any tangential path ever. So it was, to her, it was utterly simple and effortless what she did. But the rest of us who have been on a tangential path or paths, are tempted, or some are wavery, unsteady, it's difficult. It can be difficult. It is difficult. We don't have that effortlessness here. We don't have that complete, total assurance beyond even the tiniest doubt. None. Because if there's the tiniest doubt in this world now, things are going to get shaky. Things are going to get shaky. So, who knows? Who knows? At least he made a good effort there, you know. I applaud the effort, I mean, and applaud the honesty. Applaud the honesty. Shocking honesty coming from, I mean, you don't hear that. I mean, that's, I think that's the first I've heard somebody say, be that honest. Among the, you know, modern teachers, teachers that are around now, most of them are much less direct than that, and kind of, you know, want to have a big tent, and not step on any toes. Don't step on any toes, but you know, you inevitably you're going to step on toes, because, like I said, everybody's sticking their toes out now, and their toes are very sensitive, and their manicures are very, very intricate, and they're going to say, look, You scraped my pedicure. Not a manicure, pedicure. They're pedicures. They say, you scraped my pedicure. How dare you? That cost me an incredible amount of time and effort, and I'll never be able to have it going like that again. That, I'm so irritated. I'm so angry. I'm so upset. I've been so wronged. I've been so abused. And you know, the righteous indignation, just that they're able to build it, and they slug down more energy drinks and build it some more. And you say, well, I didn't touch it. You scraped it as you were sliding your foot out to try to get it under my foot as I was walking by. And they say, well, you walking by, you know, caused me to try to put my foot on under, so I, and it's your fault. And they cannot assume any responsibility for their own situation, their own upset. The fact that they chose the idea of trying to be prime creator, the fact that this must bring about a scenario of loss, and the fact that they're on tangential paths, they're unwilling to center and listen to the voice of reason, and therefore on tangential paths, they become feeling less and more and more disenfranchised from permanency, and they're feeling super impermanent and super vulnerable, and therefore every last little thing irritates them. That's their responsibility, you know? Responsibility of the guru, the teacher, is to tell them that there's a way back, but not to agree with that the upset is your fault. It's not your fault. It's their responsibility. And the only way to cure it is, again, listen to the voice of reason. You got to. So Bentino was simply sticking with the voice of reason. You know, just sticking with it. That. And did not coddle anybody, which, you know, good luck with that. You're not gonna, of course, you're not gonna pull in the sensitive, easily hurt, fragile ones who say, "Oh my gosh, can't you?" Well, like I said, those who are all messed up on tangential paths, they look to the guru as the big hammer who's gonna hammer down all the nails that are causing them all sorts of problems, their pedicures and whatnot. And so they go to the guru and, "Oh, I love you, guru. You're so wonderful. I love you. I love you. I love you. How much do you need me to love you so that you can bring the big hammer down on what's causing me all this irritation and bothering me so much?" You know, they'll say, "I'll give you anything. Just get rid of these, what's bothering me." And the guru will say, just sit quietly. That's what Punjaji said. Just sit, be still, and shut up, basically. Don't stop talking. Be still and stop talking. That's the best advice, really. That's the best advice there is. Just sit still, be still. Don't get up. I mean, you don't have to be like a stone. I'm moving around here. I'm moving around, but my base is still. My base is still. Base is very. Make your base very still. Okay. And keep it still. And then if you're being easily bothered, don't say anything. Don't say anything. Just be still. And listen. And be aware. And pay attention, because the voice of reason will speak. Will point, will help you see. And you'll stop being so bothered by stuff. You'll realize as you take the path, the progress you make is that you're not so easily bothered. It's not like I got some kind of enlightenment, you know. No. Not like I was seeing nature in a brighter way. No. Everything looked exactly the same. It's not like all the complexes were still there. But what happened was, stuff didn't bother me as much. Gradually, everything bothered me less and less and less and less and less. And now even, you know, very irritating situations just don't really cause more than a ripple, you know. Still cause a ripple, yeah. But ripple really doesn't go anywhere. I practice listening to people who are stirring up, you know, anger. Well, you can't help it, because everybody is stirring up anger in this world. Doesn't matter who you listen to. Everybody's on the hate train. So you just, you know, you listen to it, practice, listen to it, and it tries to pull me in, and then I just say, no. That's not it. Everybody's on the hate train, my gosh. And you think, well, no, there's some... there's a lot of people who... Like you're on a plane. Let's say you're on a plane. And the staff, the cabin staff, the stewards and the stewardesses, okay, they are so, you know, handsome or beautiful, and they act so graciously, and such hospitality and glamorous, whatever, and make your ride comfortable. So you don't think about, "Oh, I'm on a nice plane, nice people, everything's fine." You don't realize you're on a plane to hell. Okay, so just like that, in the world now, there's a lot of very glamorous people. Glamorous, very big. You know, and men and women. Women tend to be used extensively in this, of making it all, the journey that the world is on, making it seem very beautiful. You know, wow, look at all these beautiful people. Look at all these supremely sexy, beautiful people. You know, wow. And they're saying, "Isn't this fun? Isn't this great?" Here, have some of this. You know, have some of this. And when we get there, we'll all take our clothes off. You know, everything will be fabulous. when you get to the end of this journey, all these, you know, beautiful people will all take their clothes off, so to speak. And so you think, "Oh, wow, that maybe this journey isn't so bad after all." So you got this massive marketing of this journey that the world's on, into this tangential journey the world's on. Everybody's popping drugs and medicines and looking at these beautiful people in various states of dress or undress, and they're thinking, "Wow, when we reach this journey, you know, it's going to be like a fantasy land. Everything's going to be fabulous." Well, we're on the highway to hell. And when you're on the highway to hell, you need all this distraction so you don't realize, wait a minute, you don't hit the brakes and say, "Wait, this is terrible. I want to turn around. But, you turn on the TV, you look on the internet, wherever you are, you see all these beautiful people saying, I am so happy that you're here on this journey with me. And if you just stick with it, we're going to get even closer and closer and closer. You know, wow. You know, you think, you're going to be in like, again, fantasy land, in hedonistic fantasy land, and it's going to be incredible. That's a lie. That's the big lie. You're gonna have your head knocked. That's what you're gonna have. That is the truth. I've seen it. What's gonna happen? You're gonna get torn to pieces. That's what's gonna happen. And what is luring you into this is these beautiful people, beautiful bodies. You know, all the makeup and the glossy stuff and the hair and the voluptuous and the costumes, the clothing and the attitude and, oh, you know, let's just stay on this journey together. We're on this journey together. Wow. And so you think, wow, these goddesses and gods, they like me. They're on this journey with me. They're going to be there for me. They're relating to me. No, they're just heartless, soulless, ruthless marketers of this highway to hell is what they are. They want, you know, they're leading you into a trap. That's what they're doing. And you know, the thing is that you will gladly take having your head knocked in over experiencing total chaos, the end of this path. Anything but that. So you literally will think, my gosh, what will happen is you'll get into a situation where you'll see two options. You'll see either I continue further into total chaos, or I agree to sacrifice having my head bashed in. And you'll agree to have your head bashed in is what will happen. Anything other than that total chaos. In my situation, I went so fast and so determined to help the world, I said, no, I'm not going to have my head bashed in because I got to help the world. So I went into total chaos, that experience, and then it was so terrible, I jumped out and says, I can never have that experience again. It's absolutely the worst experience ever. People will eagerly embrace their death other than have that experience, eagerly. And so they do. But if you say, no, stick with your honesty, stick with your compassion, say, I want to help the world, I want to go to the end of this path, no death for me, I'm going to find, then you will have that brief momentary experience of total chaos. You'll jump back from it and you'll cry out and the voice of reason will appear for you, and then you will be on the path to recovery. You really will be on the path to recovery, and you will not need to come to death. You will not choose death. That's a fact too. But those in satsang, they don't have to choose death either. Because they're sitting still, they're listening to truth, they're listening to the voice of reason, they're seeing. You have to see. If you just listen academically and don't see, you're still going to choose to have your head knocked in. Because there's no seeing. So you still are in the belief in impermanence. Entirely. You have to see permanence. You not only have to see it, you have to see the reason around it, that while impermanence is based on false premise, and that false premise can never be true, but that false premises give rise to accurate logic that reaches an insane conclusion. You have to see it. So you have to see why you've been trapped, why you've gone down the false road, along with the permanence that is there for you. And in seeing this, you say, no, no reason to choose death, no reason whatsoever. So satsang is very important. It's very important. And, you know, this, the closer the world gets to extreme irritation, closer it gets to this experience of total chaos, etc., etc., the worse the journey is getting, the more you have these glamorous people, bodies in the world strutting around. You know, the more and more clothes they take off too, you know, it's no longer strong enough for them to be fully clothed and just, you know, like back in the early days of Hollywood, et cetera, you have all these stars and starlets who are very glamorous, of course, leading people astray, but, you know, very decent, you know, and then gradually indecency became more and more as we go worse, farther and farther astray. then the marketers of this, they end up taking off more and more and more clothing, becoming more and more indecent, becoming more and more vulgar, all trying to appeal to the lowest common denominator, so that you'll hang in there a little longer. And then these marketers, these stars and starlets, end up taking more and more drugs, getting more and more crazy, you know, trying to say, hey, follow me, you know, I might take off my clothes in public or something, or I might do something totally crazy. And people say, ah, wow, I'm going to follow this starlet, you know. They're really crazy. They could do anything. You know, it's very interesting. This journey is really interesting. They might, you know, the stars get together and use all sorts of drugs and have a crazy orgy and just go wild, you know. And, yeah, that, you know, what? That's weird. That's really weird. That's, I'm going to stay on this, in my seat here, in this airplane seat. Am I going to? Now, and pay attention to it. So you have all these people on Twitter and whatever following these crazy celebrities, just getting more and more wacko. And the world's flooded with pornography. That's all part of it. It's all part of it. The more tangential you get, the world gets, the more people have to have pornography to just stay on it, or have to have also flooded with fashion. Okay, you have to feel like you can dress up in really seductive, alluring ways and all of that kind of stuff, just to keep you thinking that this journey is going to pay off for you. Just to keep from putting on the brakes. Because if you didn't have that, didn't have all that stuff going on, you'd put on the brakes and you'd say, wait a minute, you know, what's going on here? I'm scared. What did I get myself into? How in the world did I get into this? And you start looking around for help. And then when you look for help, you find it. When you find it, you turn around, pull back from the abyss. So in order to get to the abyss, you know, that the world is trying to get to, which is total loss of everything, which, again, you can never have that. You can only experience total chaos, symbolic chaos. That's as far as you can go, as far as loss of everything. That's the ultimate experience of that, is total chaos, symbolic chaos, which is, I experienced that. And in order to get to that, you literally, whew, you know, one of two ways. My way was that I wanted to help the world so much. I wanted to find the truth. And I thought, well, I'm on this path. Let me go to the end of it and see if the truth is there. And not finding, I said, oh, okay, it's wrong. No truth here. Let me go back and discover real truth. Or you go along with a group think and saying, we just have to reach the end of everything. And when we do, we'll be magically transformed into greater, more than everything. So in order to get there, you have to have this unbelievable amount of degeneracy that keeps low blows, that keeps hitting you with low blows, that keeps you somehow hanging in there, even against your better judgment, you know, against your better judgment. All sorts of distractions. You know, all sorts of conflicts, all sorts of problems, and an extremely degenerate society. And you have to have the whole society working at this degeneracy, making it more and more degenerate. More and more low blows, more and more crassness and vulgarity, and nudity, and drugs, and lawlessness, and criminality, and viciousness, and brutality, and all of that. You know, in these movies that you watch, you know, keep in your seat, like you're in an airplane. Here's this movie. They got movies in the back of seats and buses and taxis and airplanes and everything. And you're watching these movies. These movies are just like, again, tangentialness coming at you, telling you it's okay, it's okay, it's okay. Look at this unbelievable stuff that's going on. It's not happening to you. It's happening out there. And you think, oh, okay, this terrible feeling I have that I'm going to have my head bashed in, it's just a movie. It's in this movie I'm watching. You know, it's in the movie I'm watching. It's not me. So see, it tricks you into this fear that you have. It's like, uh-oh, I'm going into a terrible trap. And you start saying, uh-oh, what's going on? And then they show you these movies, right? And they portray this stuff, this insane violence in the movie, along with a bunch of sex, etc. And then that gets you interested in the movie, you know, and it's glamorous people, the sexy people in the movie get you interested. And then they portray all this violence. And then you say, oh, okay, you see. No, I was wrong in being worried about it's going to happen to me. It's happening in the movie. I must have just tuned into the movie or someone talked to me about the movie. It's just in the movie. It's not going to happen to me. Delusion. very tricky stuff, because it is going to happen to you. But by portraying it in a movie, you can get confused and say, wait a minute, this fear that I have, something bad's going to happen to me. No, I saw that in a movie. I must just be reacting to what I saw in a movie. See? Very tricky. Very deceitful. Very wicked. And yet that's exactly how the world works. Exactly how the world works. And so you see all the disaster movies, right? And then when someone talks about disaster coming up, you say, oh, no, 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 you must have seen it in the movie. That's not really going to happen. That's just in a movie. So in other words, their fears of what's going to happen. As the world gets closer and closer to catastrophe and disaster, Hollywood keeps putting out these movies, the movie industry keeps putting out these movies depicting what's actually going to happen. But by putting in a movie, then everyone thinks, oh, no, that's not really going to happen. It just happened in a movie, you see. So they think, oh, my fears, it must have come from this movie. I must have watched that. You know, I'm afraid of, you know, all these terrible problems that are coming. Is that real fear, justifiable? You say, oh, no, 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 it must have come from the movie I watched, because I watched this movie and all this stuff happened in the movie, and I got real scared when I watched the movie. So it must be I'm just reacting to the movie and not intuitively aware of the trap that I'm going into. You see that? It's very simple. Once you see it, it's very simple. That's why I don't watch movies. I don't watch movies. I haven't seen any of those catastrophe movies. I don't watch them. Because I know the trap that's being set. Because then you'll start to doubt. You start to doubt your intuition. You'll start to doubt the path that the tangential path that you've been on. You'll start to doubt that anything bad could happen on you. Say, no, no, no. The stuff that I think is bad that's going to happen, no, that must have come from this movie that I watched. That's how it got into my mind, right? Through the movie. Not from your own intuitive seeing down the path, looking down the path, saying, no, wait a minute. What I'm seeing down there is very bad, very bad. What you might say is that the world has an army of whores, so to speak, that are seducing the world to keep going down this path. That's one, you know, vulgar way of saying it. And it's true. It's also true. And we can explain it, you know, in less vulgar terms. But it's nonetheless no less true and no less horrible. Horrible, right? The world is really horrible, to tell you the truth. Because in order to go down this path, we have to have all these sirens of both genders, you know, saying, look down, look how beautiful it is here. You know, it's kind of like, you look down the path and it's getting real dark and real scary, and then these beautiful people, like a flock of beautiful people show up there in all states of undress, and they're all doing all this stuff, and you say, hey, look how beautiful it is down here, you know, look how fun it is here, look how much fun we're having, wow, so sexy down here, don't you want to come down here? And you say, well, maybe I'll go a few more steps, you know, towards that. And then as you go a few more steps, they retreat further and sing their, you know, siren song of seduction to you, and try to be more, and the further darker it gets, the sexier they got to become. They got to make it seem that way. And then at the same time, you're seeing these movies depicting all this horrible stuff, and you think this horrible stuff you're seeing, oh, that's coming from the movie. I must be deluded. I must be deluded. So the combination of those two tactics are what's being used, along with drugs. Along with drugs, those tactics. These all these very sexy people acting in very sexy ways, making you think that you could join in the fun too if you just keep on down this path. Then you have the drugs that make you kind of dull the fear and the worry and concern, and make the world seem kind of bright and beautiful. And then you have the movies which make you think that the concern that you're having is came to you from this movie and not from what you're actually being aware of. Okay, so that those three elements are powerful, powerful, powerful elements, along with a consumer material culture, which, you know, is like a drug that keeps us thinking that this path is really great for us. It's not going to be a problem. Very wicked, very horrible. Entirely so, extremely so, extremely. World extremely wicked. Jesus condemned the world entirely, and still does, by the way. He said it's an absolutely horrible place. He says there's nothing good in it. You won't find it, and you'll never find anything what you want here. Never find anything good here, even. You'll only find loss here. That's all you'll ever find. In this dream of loss, all you will ever find is loss. But you can dream a different dream. so to speak. Permanence. You can experience permanence even while you appear to still appear here. You seem to still be in the world, but not of it. You can still be in the world of illusions, in the world of a dream as a body, but be experiencing permanence as you're here and shining that assurance of permanence in the world, as Ramana Maharshi did, as Ananda Mahima did, as Jesus did, as Buddha did, etc., 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 etc. Whoever you're aware of that did that, as they did that. In the world, but radiating, shining this total unconcern, total assurance, all is well, all is well, all is well. Don't worry, all is well. There's only a dream. The dream of loss. The dream of destruction. Dream of loss. Keep in mind, you can't lose something unless you first believe that you have it. So everything that we think we have in this world is only for the purpose that we lose it. Okay, but if you realize you don't have anything you have in this world at all, then how can you lose anything? That's kind of the secret of it, is realizing this world is really nothing. You don't have anything here. You don't have anything, nothing real. Because whatever is real is permanent. And there's nothing permanent in existence, so you have nothing. You have nothing. So how can you lose anything? You never had it in the first place. That's kind of the non-dual, you know, the high way of saying, you know, you're never born. You were never born. So how can you die? You know, from an ultimate standpoint, that is absolutely true. Non-dual is like a shortcut, but it's not easy for a lot of people to take a shortcut. And A Course in Miracles gives you a little more assurance and support for a path that takes a little longer. You know, it gives you support for that. Whereas like the non-dual, you feel like, gosh, I went to Satsang and, you know, I didn't get it. I tried and didn't quite get it, and what's wrong with me? You know, maybe I'm not cut out for it. Whereas on other A Course in Miracles path, for instance, tells you, hey, it takes a while, it's difficult, and there's a lot of, you know, you really need to get used to, familiar with the voice of reason, seeing truth, and gradually stuff bothers you less and less, and eventually you'll be able to snap out of it, eventually. Yeah, so satsang, you know, is a shortcut or just a snapping out of it. I mean, non-dual satsang is a snapping out of it, and some people are ready to snap out of it, so they do. But for those who are not ready to snap out of it, they don't snap out of it. So that's how it goes. That's how that goes. And that's a fact. How are we doing here? This is, by the way, 2:27. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. What time is it? It is 7:38. The Olympics are on television. And here I am. I'm not watching it. What a surprise. I don't watch movies either. Don't watch movies either, because I know what the purpose of movies is. It's a most wicked purpose. It disenfranchises you. It's a way of trying to disenfranchise yourself. It's a way for you not to trust your own deepest feelings and intuitions. You're thinking, oh, it must have come from a movie. Therefore, it's just fantasy. It's not really going to happen. And of course, there are some movies that are just fantasy. They're not going to happen. Those are put out there too, to kind of confuse the situation even more so. You say, well, I don't know which movie to go to, because some are about what's really going to happen, but making me think it's only going to happen in a movie, and there's about to not happen. So, well, there's an easy solution to that, which the voice of reason told me. Very easy solution. Don't go see any movies. That's what I did. You're cured. See? Problem solved, just like that. No problem. Don't have to... Because, you know, it's hell trying to figure out which ones to see. And you'll try to, you know, get lists from people and ask teachers, what movie, is this movie okay to see or not? You know, actually, no movie is good to see, really. Hardly. You know, not really. Videos, a little different. A little different situation. Because, like a satsang video, that's okay. That's fine. Someone sitting there, you know, sharing truth and assurance is fine. It's okay. You're in control, right? You can stop it whenever you want to. You're entirely in control. It's small. You understand there's not going to be any surprises in there. No one's going to bushwhack you. And it can be helpful and effective in that way. But you know, watching, deciding to try and watch movies is like walking a tightrope over Niagara Falls, you know. I mean, you are really asking for trouble. Really asking for it. So for me, voice of reason just said, hey, cut them all out. Cut them all out. Before I did that, it had me go through a period where I watched movies all day, every day. I watched about six movies a day. Back at that time, it was VHS. And I watched six VH movies a day, every day, month after month after month after month after month. Every movie I wanted to watch, I'd watch. And then at some point, then finally, the voice of reason told me, okay, now we're going to shift things. And says, now, let's stop watching movies altogether. And I said, hey, no problem, no problem, no worries. And from that point on, I never watched another movie. How long has that been? 15 years or more, probably. Never watched another movie since then, really. Possible I may have watched one or two, and I didn't like it at all. I just kind of, because I was with somebody who wanted to watch it, but I just kind of paid no attention to it, really. It was terrible, terrible experience. Hated it. Because I know how movies work. They sort of separate us from our deepest wisdom and intuition and from trusting ourselves. So you have a world that has been raised on movies. You have two or three generations that have been raised on movies. Maybe even four generations. We'll see, one, two, four generations. One, two, three, at least four. One, two, three, three and a half, whatever, have been raised on movies. And television, definitely. And that has divorced them from their deepest wisdom. Got them to distrust it. They say, no, I can't trust that. That comes from a movie, and we all know that movies aren't real, right? I say, oh, the world is going to, you know, be burned by fire. I saw that in a movie, so I know that this feeling must be coming from a movie, and I know the movie's just, you know, fake, make-believe, so I know it can never happen. It's not going to happen. See, that's what happens. That is what happens. So then you think, going down this tangential road, there's no, okay, what's the big deal? You know, it's not going to be disastrous. But all that stuff works together. All works together. And keeps you going down that tangential road. And then, on the other hand, you have satsang with various teachers. There's lots of teachers on YouTube and around the world. And depending on what you like, you know, there's all different types. And what their purpose is to get you to sit still, get you to focus on reason, the voice of reason, to see through past illusion, which the voice of reason just sees right past it, like it wasn't even there, to see it, to see permanence, to realize that permanence is true, it's still permanent, permanence is still permanent, and that is true, nothing has changed that, permanence is still permanent, and to see it, and just to sit very still, very calm, very relaxed, for extended periods of time. That's why I make these videos so long for you. That's really a service, you know. It's not easy. It's not difficult now. I can do it. Not a problem. But, you know, most videos are like 5 minutes. It's a quick non-dual thing. It's like, boom, quick hit. Because they know everyone's really busy and on tangential paths. And they say, okay, can you just give 5 minutes here? Just 5 minutes and say, okay, maybe I can listen to Muji for 5 minutes. And, you know, and then it's very profound. But then what do you do with the next 2 hours or 3 hours? You see, off on tangents again, maybe, probably, almost assuredly. So the ability to sit quietly for a long period of time is the greatest ability in the world. If you have that ability, the other abilities don't matter. Really, they don't matter. I mean, I can't do hardly anything in this world. Really, I don't have any abilities. But I can do this. And so it doesn't bother me that I can't do the rest of the stuff. Because this is the one ability, if you can do this, the rest doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. Because this is the one that counts. The rest of the ones, they don't count. Doesn't matter. This one does matter. Your ability to sit quietly, to continue focus for a long period of time, and to be still, and listen, and hear, and see what reason shows you. It says, look here, look here. See what I'm talking about? You see what I'm talking about, so to speak? That is the one ability that will truly succeed for you. That actually will succeed. The only one. The only one. Have to do it. Have to do it. So I make these videos long so that you have opportunity to practice doing it. It's the same thing if you go to a satsang, you can sit there for 4 hours, maybe. Maybe 4 in the morning, 4 in the afternoon, or something like that. And you have to, really be still, be quiet, and listen, and go for it. It's quite a discipline. And it's the one ability that is all important, and the other ones don't really matter. Don't matter at all. And so the Olympics, they're boom, they're going on, all this kind of stuff. I used to watch them, but now it's go time now. You cannot fool around now. You cannot. If you've listened to this video, the case has been laid out to understand that we've gone on such tangential paths for so long, and we've been watching these movies and television, and we have all these glamorous, sexy people, and all these drugs, and all these distractions that have seduced us into continuing down this path for so long without putting the brakes on, that we're now about ready to go over the edge. And when you get to that point, you start becoming very sensitive, easily bothered, irritated by other stuff, by everything. Everything, bugs you severely. And you add that to the stimulus, the caffeine and everything, and the whole ball of wax, you get people going into full hater mode. So the world's on the hate train. So many, not just individual people, but groups of people are on the hate train now. And they're looking for the hammer. And there's no breaks. There's no breaks. So it's supremely important now, as this hate becomes institutionalized, it's supremely important that you be able to sit still for long periods of time and listen to truth. Supremely important. Which is why I try to put out these videos on a continual basis, so at least, it's there as an option. Because you cannot keep responding to all these hate groups, because they're all over the place, from all angles. Everybody's hating on everybody, because everybody's upset by the slightest little thing. Oh, I didn't like your tone of voice. You're fired. People are getting fired for anything now. That's how it's going. Even under these drastic economic circumstances, people are being fired for the just ridiculous stuff. It's like someone says, I'm irritated with this group of people. You're fired, See, that's not the way out. The way out is forgiveness. When someone says, I hate these people. Just, okay. Now, why don't you just sit still for a while and focus on truth? Okay. Because everybody's in the hate mode. You have to have forgiveness is the only way out of it. It's the only way out of it. Firing somebody is not for forgiveness. If somebody says something you don't like, you say, okay, what do I need to do? I need to sit still and listen to satsang and practice inquiry. That's what I need to do. If I'm bothered, I need inquiry, period. No, instead of now, they're bringing out the hammer and firing people. Firing people right now is almost like a death sentence. Stress-wise, stress kills. And if it's not a death sentence, if the safety net can keep them from starving, whatever, their life unravels when you get fired. If you get fired now, you probably won't get another job. So it's literally a vicious, vicious thing to fire somebody right now. In the past, different story. But people feel, I quit this job. I quit. I'm going to go find another job. But right now, no way. You got a family. You got children. Getting fired for just whatever you did or said is politically incorrect. That's just an incredible hate. It's not forgiveness. No way. So what people have to do is they have to start practicing forgiveness. And forgiveness starts with us, meaning I need to cool down. I need to sit still. I need to ask for the voice of permanence to speak to me. And I need to pay attention to that, so I'm not so easily bothered by what somebody said about me. So I'm not so easily bothered by the way someone looked at me, or a comment they made, or their attitude, or the pace of how they're working, or on and on and on and on. I'm not so bothered. Oh, that they said they like somebody and I hate that person they said they liked. I'm so extremely bothered by that. I want them to lose their job over it. You know, if you're bothered, it's your problem. So you need to practice satsang and inquiry. And of course, we're not encouraging people to hate on other people just because it's your own problem if you react to it. No, of course not. Because hating on people too, that is your problem. That's not forgiveness either. So everybody needs to practice forgiveness now, which is what A Course in Miracles says. Came into this world to try to help the situation. But it needs to help a whole lot more. And, you know, we've got to try. And for me, I need to be more actualized in this. I'm doing what I can do. But, you know, nobody wants to get out there and really be hammered on right now because the hate is extreme. It's extreme. We're in the time of extremism. You know, the actual head banging, you know, is going on in various places in the world, to say the least. You know, preview, trailer. You know, just look at the Arab Spring for a trailer of what's to come. Full-on head banging. And we've had, you know, in Afghanistan, full-on headbanging there. Now the Arab Spring, all those countries there. So, I mean, it is, you know, those are trailers of what's to come. The people you know, what's going on. People just, you know, wrapping themselves in bombs and going into public, right? What is that? It's going on every single day. It's better to wrap yourself in a prayer shawl and sit quietly in a place of worship, your place of worship, and read some holy book or read a book of truth and let that speak to you about forgiveness. The number one teaching right now has got to be, for the world in general, forgiveness. Forgiveness. You know, non-dual teaching and the higher levels of that teaching is that you got to see the voice of reason all the way through into unconditional love and see the stability, experience stability for yourself. Experience it for yourself. That's the ultimate goal. But as we're getting there, you cannot turn things around without forgiveness in this world. Cannot turn it around. And, you know, instead of an Olympics, we should be having a world meeting of forgiveness. You know, it's tough because a lot of the people teaching forgiveness are just glamorous people who are actually using that as a cover for their keeping people going down the wrong path. They realize that, hey, this teaching of forgiveness is going to get people to slam on the brakes and turn around, and that will cause us not to be saved again, thinking that losing everything is to gain everything. To destroy reality means we'll be reborn as greater in reality. That's the underlying belief of existence. And so those who believe that want everybody to go to absolute destruction. And they see this teaching of forgiveness come in the world, and they say, oh my gosh, this is going to ruin the loss of everything, because some people are going to put on the brakes and not go this way. We want everybody to be destroyed. So what they do is they align with this teaching of forgiveness and pretend to be teachers of forgiveness, all the while teaching an underlying message that is opposite of that and moving people, seeing them to continue down the path of destruction. So we have a lot of that in the world. There's a lot of those who are out there trumpeting that they're teachers of forgiveness, and they're wolves in sheep's clothing. That's a fact. So everybody's gun shy, you know. Everybody's like, you know, boy, who do I trust? You know, it's very tough to trust. It's very tough to trust anybody. But the one thing you can trust is your own seeing. The reason within you sees truth. It sees it. So for me, the question, who do I trust? Well, I trust my own capacity to see truth, because it is within me. I know it's within me. It's within you. It's within anyone. So that ultimately, that is what can be trusted, ultimately. Beyond even the greatest teachers, your own seeing is that which is most trustworthy. So you have to get in touch with your own seeing. Yeah, that is all important, all important. And how you do that is up to you. Everyone's different how they do that. But certainly you have to do it. One way or the other, you got to do it. And you have to do it consistently, and keep doing it somehow. Get in touch with your own clarity, the voice of reason that points out, you know, that the permanent is still permanent. No worries. And in fact, you want that. And all the rest of this stuff is just a fantasy. The fantasy of loss has no consequences ever. You can see it. And then so you pull away, you pull back from the abyss, you know. And trusting in that, you're able to see through the teachers who are teaching underlying that where they're teaching is a misdirection. They seem to be teaching forgiveness, but they're really seducing you in the wrong direction, towards glamour, towards false love, special relationships, worshiping bodies, worshiping people, thinking that love it can be found there in impermanence. In other words, they're still just telling you that impermanence can solve the problems of impermanence is what they're really teaching. And you can see it. You can see it. It's all over the place. There's some true teachers in the world, and there's some false ones too. No question about it. And you have to see it for yourself. I can't give names or anything, because it's my own seeing that sees it. So your own seeing has to see it. I'm just giving you the parameters, the dynamic of it all, so you know, can help you. When you see it, you're gonna say, ah, okay, yeah, I remember that. I heard something of that. And you're gonna say, ah, you're gonna trust it more. But you have to see it for yourself. You know, I've seen it. I see it all along. It's like, wow. Very possible to appear to be teaching truth in this world, but teach a mixed message, which ultimately confuses people and causes them to continue on down this this false path. Happens all the time. This passive distraction, you know, irrelevancy. Happens all the time. So you just have to continue to practice right discernment. And again, voice of reason will see. We'll see very quickly. You can see it. You'll see it. You'll see it. And you say, what is that? How can I see it? What is that seeing? And you think intellectually. How did I get there intellectually? No, it's beyond the intellect. It's a direct seeing. It's an actual seeing of truth. You can see truth, and we were not created this way because we had no reason to see truth, because we directly experienced it. Okay, so our spirit was not created with reason, because we were directly experiencing reality and truth. No reason to see it when you can directly experience it. When we chose to try and lose reality, then there was a need for us to be able to see reality. So the prime creator put reason within us. Okay, when I first came across reason, voice of reason, I was shocked. I said, where did this come from? I didn't have this before. I was like, amazing. I said, how is this possible? I'm able to see reality. I didn't have this capability before. So it is actually an add-on capability that the Prime Creator gave to us so that we could get free of this insanity, this attempt to lose reality. Whether we think reality is impermanent, we're stuck in this without reason. We couldn't see reality, and we couldn't be assured that it's still real. That we couldn't see permanence, and we couldn't be assured that permanence is still real. We couldn't be assured of it, so we would really be very badly stuck. We'd have to just leap back into reality, which we would do eventually, but it would be a very, very, very long time before we did that. And we'd suffer horribly before we did that. Horribly. Really. So the voice of reason being there gives us a way to now see permanence before we directly experience it again. Okay? Seeing it is not the same as directly experiencing it. It's not the same. Okay, so we do have this capacity now. You have to discover this within yourself. Just ask for it, and you'll receive it. Ask and you shall receive. And you'll see something. You'll say, oh my gosh, where'd this come from? I never saw that before. How could I see that? I didn't even know I could see that. Amazing, amazing, amazing. That's reason and the voice of reason, which is within all of us. It's within all of us. We all have it. Every aspect of spirit has the voice of reason within them now. So everyone will be saved. Everyone. Just a matter of you know, when they finally decide to listen. You know, they will. Because the paths that they're on are bring terrible, terrible suffering, bring severe irritation, severe conflict, severe hatred. And if you go all the way, total chaos, symbolic chaos. That's what it brings. So there is no good story on these paths, false paths. There is no good story on them. The good story only happens when you start listening to the voice of reason. And you can see permanency, literally, okay? First thing I saw permanency. I said, what in the world? I said, oh my gosh, permanency is still permanent. I saw it absolutely clear. I said, permanency is still permanent and it will always be so. I said, oh my gosh, then this world is just a fantasy. It doesn't have any effect on reality whatsoever. I saw it. That was the first thing I saw it. I said, wow, okay. Let's work on dropping this fantasy. Let's work on it. Let's work on that. And the voice of reason said, yeah, you got to work at it. You got to work at it. But you can do it. You can do it. You will do it. You will do it for sure. So, here is the opportunity to practice this. And ultimately, you have to see. And your discernment has to come from your seeing. Has to. Because I'm telling you, some teachers that are giving mixed messages and literally, you know, who've tried to appropriate true teaching to cover up what they're really about, they can be very, very appealing and tricky. Very much so. Those who have not had a glimpse of permanence can be deceived, can be misled by them. Absolutely can. What saved me was I saw permanence, and then the voice of reason backed it all up. And I said, well, you know, whatever in the world, I know that permanence is still permanent. And all I got to do is drop this fantasy. So let's just keep working at that. And whoever helps me, thank you. But I know eventually it's my own decision. You know, I have to see it clearly enough so I do it. No one can do it for me. And so you just keep working at that and try not to get pulled off track too much. It'll happen. It'll happen. Just get back on track, you know. And if something resonates, you know, pay attention. If it doesn't resonate, okay. But by all the way, stay within your own contemplation. Stay within your own effort to remain still and quiet and listen and see. Stay with your own effort. Stay with your own effort. That's the one thing you can count on, right? You can't control anybody else's effort. You can't control my effort, right? I could stop making videos tomorrow. Who knows? Can't control that. But you can control your own effort. The one thing you can control is your own effort, your right effort. You can make right effort every day, as I have tried to do. You can do it. I've done it. I guarantee you can do it over a long period of time. Every day, you can do it. I've done it. So, because you can control it. You can control that. You can control your own effort. You can't control anybody else's effort. So, make sure that your effort is up to par. And then you know you're doing the best you can do. You're doing really great. You know it. And then, of course, others along the way can be help reassure you and help you keep doing that. Keep doing that. But you don't substitute at any teacher for your own efforts. Okay? You have to make your own efforts to see. In other words, don't just say, I found a wonderful teacher, and I'm just going to sit with them. Well, sitting is great, but thinking like, okay, my own efforts, I don't need them anymore, so to speak. You still have to see and choose for yourself. So your own efforts have to continue. Ananda Mahatma didn't stay with people very long. She'd say, look, if I stay with you very long, you're just going to just kind of be in bliss out. And she says, I gotta go so that you can get back to your spiritual practice. And my purpose of coming here was to help you, inspire you to do more practice, not just to hang around and bliss out with me. That's good. But you should not continue that on. I don't want to continue that on because complexes could arise around that. Get back to your spiritual practice. Get back to your seeing. Get back to your effort. And so she'd move on, constantly moving on, constantly moving on. Very few people stayed with her continuously. Very few. Mostly short periods of time. And even Jesus, when he left, he said, where are you going? He said, I got to leave. It's good for you that I leave. He says, it's good for you. Because now you have to rely on the voice of reason, which is within. He called it the Holy Spirit, the voice of reason, that you now have. You now have that within you. Everybody has that. That was basically the symbol. That was a way of telling the world, everybody has this voice of reason within them, because the Prime Creator put it there. And he says, I got to go now because it's good for you, because now you'll have to rely on that voice of reason that won't clarify everything for you, which is what it'll do. Which is what it'll do. Some people can benefit from being with a teacher for periods of time. But usually most not. Some can somehow integrate the whole thing and maintain their own strong effort and focus on seeing, and also get a huge boost from the teacher too, and not just get into a situation of thinking, oh, I wonder what I can get the teacher to do for me to get rid of this irritation. that's the problem. That's the problem that comes up. So all these tangential, paths that people are on, there's no good story on any of them, except everyone will discover a voice of reason within them at some point. And then that becomes the journey back becomes a very interesting journey. Not easy, but full of milestones. Okay, we're reaching the recording limit, which is very cool, which means 3 hours. And it's been great spending this time. Hopefully you will spend more time now. As again, I told you, as I say, 2012 is extremely important. The world is reaching a breaking point. It has reached a breaking point. The number of people on the hate train is overwhelming. And it's not going to get better. It's going to get much, much, much worse. You're going to be fired over the slightest thing. And just the people are living in terror right now. I don't dare, it's like, oh my gosh, it's like, in the terrible control systems we had in the past, the people, just go to work, they're just terrified. I hope I don't upset my colleague, I hope they're not angry with me. They're going to report me to somebody and say they can't do their job because I bothered them. And people live in this horrible fear, losing their job, being thrown in jail, being never seen again. So we live in a that time, and so it's very important to go time. And so here we have the Olympics and all these beautiful people saying, don't worry, be happy, everything's cool. No worries, man, everything's fine. But they're talking about the world, they're not talking about reality. You get a teacher who tells you about reality, say, don't worry, everything's fine, that's a whole different story. You realize there's different reassurance there. But we got this whole song and dance saying, don't worry, the world's great, everything's fine, we're all on track and headed towards utopia. Nonsense. The opposite of that. So, again, voice of reason will tell you that the permanent is still permanent and will always be permanent, and that is your home, and you can awaken to that fact. So stay with this, stay with inquiry, stay with satsang, even though you might find it slightly difficult. As you look back in hindsight, you'll say, oh my God, that's the greatest thing I ever did. Greatest thing I ever did. When the going got tough, I got going. When the chips were down, I came through. When the world really needed me in the best way, I responded, and I was truly responsible, and I helped at least help those who were willing to be helped, okay? So that's it. Very great. Nearing the limit right now. We're going right to the edge here. I don't know if I want to. I'm sure it'll save it automatically, but we'll stop it anyway. Okay, very great. That's it for this video. Here we go, up on the 3-hour mark. Boom, boom.